it's not going to carry your voice very well, is it? You switched on, so you don't really need
so
that.
So I don't need it, actually. Thank you. That's a good point.
I don't want to be on TV with this black thing up here.
Oh, I know. And I feel Linda gave me the microphone before, and I just felt that performance side of me, like going, I need to sing a song.
Oh, God, no.
Silly. Well, I don't know. That might be... No, Wendy said... I don't know if they're waiting to watch, but they... Mum always makes me wear woolly singlets. She started this habit in me as a little kid, and she always, have you got a woolly singlet on? So I said to my roommate this morning, God, I've gone and put my woolen singlet on. I hope I won't regret that. I am fully regretting it right now.
Thank you. conference in Rotorua this year. We're really excited to have put together these workshops for this afternoon, which are something a little bit different, and as many of you know, from the usual format to the Dressage AGM. So we're really excited to have our three keynote speakers here today. So first of all, we have Jen, who you would have heard from this morning. Genevieve is a practicing barrister in Tauranga, where she's lived for the last 10 years. So we're lucky, she's local for us. She was admitted to the bar in 2000, and she's worked in New Zealand and Australia. And her litigation experience includes insurance, construction, employment and criminal law. She has a particular passion in sports law and studied sport law at the University of Canterbury. And she was taught by New Zealand's leading sports academic, Elizabeth Toomey. And she's currently, as you know, our rules officer for Dressage New Zealand. A practical and informative session on the basics of good health and safety practice for dressage groups in New Zealand. I'm sure that Ben's going to enthrall us all with the upcoming legislation. So I'll hand you over to Jen.
Thanks. Okay, so to begin, we all ready to go? Okay. Well, I think the reality of health and safety is that when most people think about it, I literally think eyes glaze over. And it's just almost overwhelming. So my purpose today is to talk about where we're at the moment, very briefly, look at where the reform is heading, but make it applicable to you, okay? So this, my intent is not to give you a blow-by-blow account of what the legislation may be. It's about looking at what you can do to make sure you're prepared. But just to begin and lead you all into it, I just want to show you a very short clip I found on YouTube. So I think that pretty well, just better turn that off, make sure nothing crazy is going to happen. Whoopsie daisies, I'll get rid of that. Don't want to inadvertently broadcast things over the internet that are inappropriate. Right, okay, so health and safety, don't panic, get prepared. I'm a big believer in taking a civil defence mode to these types of things. And this is probably something I was really fortunate to learn when I practiced in Australia. So I practiced in Australia as a lawyer in the insurance and litigation industry. And in Australia, public liability is not like we have here. We have ACC. And so in Australia, it's much like America. And people can actually sue if they consider you have caused them harm. Okay? And there's sometimes some quite good things about that because it does keep people sort of really focused on what the issues are. And that gave me, I believe, quite a good grounding and sort of understanding where some of the pitfalls could be going forward for New Zealand. So, the purpose of this presentation, I want to provide an overview of the current health and safety regime as it applies to sports bodies, summarise the changes to the health and safety regime as it applies to sports bodies once the new bill is passed into law, and then provide a practical guide on how organisations should approach health and safety. I found that on the internet as well. And I think that's the thing. Things can happen, okay? So what do we do about it? At the moment, health and safety is governed in New Zealand by the Health and Safety Employment Act 1992. And that sets out these general duties which must be met by employers to ensure safety of their employees, and the employers must take all practicable steps to ensure the safety of employees while at work. Who here is an employer? Okay, who here is an employee? Okay, have you in those roles as employer or employee considered health and safety as it applies to you? Put your hand up if you have. Okay, so there's a degree of understanding. What is interesting though is how many of you didn't put your hand up even though you are either an employer or an employee. This is something that is there. It actually governs the way we work and how we employ people and ask people to work all the time. And yet, until something happens, often people don't really turn their mind to it. The critical thing though now is that employer means someone who employs any other person to do work for hire or reward. And in relation to an employee, it means an employer of the, or sorry, in relation to an employee, means the employer of the employee. An employee can include volunteers, okay? So you don't have to necessarily be paid for your work to be protected by the current Health and Safety and Employment Act. However, in relation to sports clubs and associations, there is currently an express exclusion on the application of the duties and obligations under the present Health and Safety Act. And that's really important. What that means is that if anyone who volunteers their time is injured, hurt, killed in undertaking that work, the penalties or obligations under the present Health and Safety Act won't apply to the sports body or organisation. Okay? So what's the Health and Safety Reform Bill going to do? I like the gloves on the donkey's face. Well, the first thing is, it's actually based on the Australian regime. And this is really interesting to me, because when I worked in Australia, which was 10 years ago, the partner I worked for in one of Australia's leading insurance law firms once remarked to me that Australia is 10 years behind the States, and generally speaking, New Zealand's 10 years behind Australia as far as critical legislative change is concerned. And while I was working in Australia, one of the areas that I did a lot of work in was the Building Act, 1993. And it was a Victorian statute, and so a lot of the liability work I did in the construction industry was in relation to that act. And when I returned to New Zealand in 2004, New Zealand was bringing in the Building Act 2004. And so I was able to take the experience I'd had in Australia working on that act, which was literally 10 years ahead, and apply that and be able to predict some of the things that New Zealand could expect by the implementation of this new act. And I have to say, pretty much all of the predictions in relation to the fundamental changes of that act have come through. And so I think that kind of reinforces that idea that we are 10 years behind Australia, and so I'll be really interested to see how our New Zealand courts respond to this act. In most cases, where there's any uncertainty about the application of sections, and that will happen when things go wrong and things are put to the test, the courts will look to the Australian experience. And also, in terms of the administrators of the new regime, they'll look to the Australian experience. So I think there's a lot to be learnt there in terms of policy and procedure that can be used. There's a lot of intellectual property and experience we can draw on. The most important thing is there's going to be creation of what we call the new duty holder. Okay, so under the other regime that we've got at the moment, it's talking about the employer. Now that's going to change to the person conducting a business or an undertaking. And interestingly, business or undertaking is not defined. And probably for very good reason, because I suspect that they're wanting to capture as many types of enterprise as possible that could form reasonably a business or an undertaking. And person doesn't necessarily mean an individual. It can mean a corporate entity, or it can mean something like a trust, or an incorporated society, or a body corporate, or an unincorporated group. So my question there is, why do sports clubs and associations like ESNZ, Dressage New Zealand, and our local clubs and area groups need to know about and understand this regime? In simple terms, it's going to apply to us. Because the express exclusion for sports clubs and associations under the current Health and Safety Act has not been included in the Health and Safety Reform Bill. This is causing a degree of anxiety, and so there is the possibility of political lobbying watering this down, but at the moment it represents the Australian situation. And I think we can expect that there will have to be a degree of application of the general principles under the Act to ensure health and safety, particularly of volunteers who are involved in sports and recreation groups, to make sure that they are safe. So, what are we going to do? So, I'm not saying that this is how it's got to be, but I'm looking at it and I want to give all of you some meaningful tools to be able to go away and not get overwhelmed by this. Because on a personal level, I sit on the board of Dressage New Zealand. And when this bill comes through and is passed into legislation, all of a sudden I carry a much more significant liability, as do my colleagues who sit on the board. I need to know that I'm doing everything I possibly can, together with the rest of my colleagues on the board, to ensure that we are meeting our obligations under this new Act. And the same will be expected of us by ESNZ. The board of ESNZ will have expectations of us to ensure that we're doing everything properly. For any of you that the club is an incorporated group, those of you who sit on committees, any of you, if you're a board of trustee on a school board, it's going to have an impact on you. Okay, so you need to know. So you need, step one, you need to understand how it works. Step two, review your club and association's current health and safety policies and procedures. Step three, identify areas for concern, work, updating. Step four, get guidance if you're unsure about how and what to do. You're not going to know everything, so get help. Go to the people who might be able to give you the right answers. But don't put your head in the sand and ignore it. And the other, the last one, is you've got to do all of the above every year. Okay? So I'm going to go through each of these steps now. Okay. So step one, and that was right before my test, I can say. A sheep decided to go into the arena I was about to ride in. And that's Murray Anderson, if any of you can picture it running and getting the lamb out of the way. So the first thing is, you know, how's it going to affect you? Well, the first is that the person conducting or undertaking a business or undertaking will include incorporated societies. Now, the current bill doesn't specifically say that, but I've taken some guidance here from a paper written by Sports New Zealand, and they're very clear that on their review, incorporated societies will be captured by the Act, and I believe that is correct. But from, again, from a slightly legally pedantic point of view, they've been quite prescriptive about describing a number of entities, particularly unincorporated groups. So I will wonder if that gets tidied up a little. But I think we can proceed on the basis that incorporated societies will be deemed a duty holder. There will be new definitions of work, worker, and workplace. Okay? and they're going to be amended to ensure that there is a duty for health and safety for all work being or undertaken in all areas where it's being undertaken. And the most important thing is that means a sports ground will become a workplace. And that means anyone volunteering will be deemed a worker. There are new obligations for officers of these entities, of these duty holders. And so an officer will include trustees, board members, directors, and people who make decisions that affect the whole or a substantial part of the business or undertaking. So in the case of our group, that will include the SNZ board, the Dressage New Zealand board, the club committees, anyone who sits in that formal capacity that actually has responsibility for things. So we need to take quite a deep breath at this point, because that is a major move from where we're at the moment. So what are these obligations? Well, the most important thing is that the duty of the officers is to exercise due diligence to ensure the PCBU complies with its duties. And so the primary duty is to ensure safety. Okay? And so then we say, well, how far does that go? Well, you've got to go as far as is reasonably practicable to ensure the health and safety of the workers employed or engaged by the entity are safe while they're undertaking their work. And that the most, and this is really interesting, that the activities they carry out are influenced or directed by the entity while they're carrying out the work. Okay, so they're not just doing their own thing, they're not being independent and just saying, well, I'm going to decide to go and do this, that there's actually direct influence of how they're doing things. And the entity must also ensure that so far as reasonably practicable, that the health and safety of other people is not put at risk from work carried out by the PCBU. Okay? It's all very interesting, but what does this actually mean? Well, what the Ministry of Business and Innovation says, and I'll read it out directly. It says, what this means is that boards are responsible for determining high-level health and safety strategy and policy which managers are required to implement. Okay, so that means the ESNZ board is going to be responsible for determining a high-level health and safety strategy and policy, which they will then ask under our present constitution for the Board of Dressage New Zealand to ensure that they implement, then through our managers, our administrators. In practical terms, that's likely to be through the work that Wendy does in engaging with all of the area groups. It's for ensuring that all of the area groups understand what the ESNZ expectations are of health and safety strategy and policy. There will also be a responsibility on the Dressage New Zealand board to develop health and safety strategy that actually applies to dressage. And in the same way, feed that through to the people who are on the ground doing the work. So this strategy and policy must take into consideration all of those affected by the organisation's activities, not just workers. So let's put it out to you. Who do you think are the people that could be affected by a Dressage New Zealand or Equestrian Sports New Zealand health and safety strategy and policy? Who are what we would call the stakeholders? Anybody? The riders. Okay, so we've got the riders. Who else? The OCs?
Volunteers.
Volunteers, right. The public, that's right. Anybody else? Yeah. The caretakers. So far, just to recap, we've got the riders, we've got the OC, or officials, we've got spectators, we've got the caretakers, the people who are responsible for the grounds. Anybody else that you can think of? Okay, that's good. All right, so you've got to mind those people. So you have to then think, what are the things that are likely to affect or be relevant to those groups? So if you're a rider, what are the areas that we need to be thinking about? Let's just take that group for the first part, the riders. And what I want you to think about is, when are they arriving at the sports ground? How are they arriving at the sports ground? What are they doing? Okay, and where will they be moving on the sports ground? So what are some of the things that you're going to have to think about? Traffic control, someone said. Good. Yes? Yeah. So we've got traffic control. That's a really good one. And I'm going to speak more about that. Yes?
Control of the spectators?
Yes. Control of the spectators.
Yarding.
Yep. Sorry, and what was that?
Controlling the sheep.
Yes, control the sheep. But that's a good point, because you've got to think of other external environmental factors that may have an impact. What about the weather? No, but is the weather something that you need to contemplate? Okay, so someone has said as in footing. Yes, that's one aspect. Don't just think about weather as being really wet. What are the extremes of weather? High winds. Heat. Okay. Lightning. Okay. There have been incidents of people struck by lightning while riding horses. Okay. So don't be blinkered. You've got to think broadly. But what I want that exercise is to think about, do it step by step. Categorize. Okay. Write your groups down. So all of the area group delegates, if you haven't taken notes, we will be putting something together. But I just want you to think, who are the people who are going to be coming onto the ground? And then within each of those groups, start thinking about the things that may be relevant to that particular group. Yes, so someone's made the point about, what about the person who just comes onto the ground and they're walking their dog? Yes, and that's something that is typical. The person who's completely unhorsey or has no understanding of what a horse may or may not do in certain circumstances is going to be something you have to contemplate. Okay, so then, board members' responsibility, however, does not stop with the issuing of strategy and policy, as they should also ensure that it's implemented effectively. Okay, so it's not good enough for ESNZ, the Board of Dressage New Zealand, to say, there's our health and safety policy, tick, great, done, we don't have to worry. We need to make sure that we have systems in place to be confident that health and safety policy is actually being implemented. Okay? So what you can expect is that we are going to be asking you questions, which we've actually already begun. So in anticipation of this new regime, one of the things that myself and Linda Clarke organised was the area health check. And the purpose of that was for us on the Board of Dressage New Zealand to gain a really comprehensive understanding about where everything's at. Now, I had it written down, and I haven't got my notes, but of the respondents, 15 area groups didn't have a health and safety policy. Five did, of the various entities that responded. So there's work to be done, okay? Because at a very basic level, you have got to have your own health and safety policy that is relevant to your group, to your sports ground where you're holding your events, and the people who are involved. And so again, it goes on to say the board ensures it's implemented effectively. They do this by holding management to account through processes of policy and planning, delivery, monitoring, and review. So going forward, you will expect to hear from us more on this. This will be something we have to be certain we are following up on. Okay, so the next step is review your club and association's current health and safety policies and procedures. So like I said, a lot of you don't have any, okay? And so I've got the figure slightly wrong. It was 14 area groups didn't have health and safety and five did. So the first thing is, like I said, you need to understand your risk. So do your area group audit. And this is what, look, this is what I recommend, and you may have different views of it. I would be very surprised if within your group you haven't got somebody who's actually getting a lot of this information through their own workplace, either as an employer or as an employee. The Ministry of Business and Innovation has been very proactive at the moment in running workshops. I know the Employer and Manufacturers Association has been doing a lot of workshops. There's a wealth of information out there. Lots of businesses are really getting their head around this new regime. And so what I recommend is find someone within your group who has some expertise, or at the very least has a good head on their shoulders and is thorough, okay? And I'm sure that there's someone within each group who can do this. And go and get them to go to your sports ground and make a list of all the actual or potential hazards. It might be you could make it a get-together, and there could be a group of you that go round. And again, think about who comes onto your ground and think about the areas they're going to go. You need to check your yards. You need to check your toilets and utility blocks. You need to check any buildings and so on. You need to check their integrity. Are they structurally sound? Are there any electrical wirings exposed? Is there any work that needs to be done? Make a list, okay? Common sense has to be the guide, okay? Don't get silly about it, but on the other hand, I'd urge you to sit on the side of caution on this. It's better to have a more comprehensive list and know that you've pretty well got everything covered than to just go, oh, no, it looks all right, we'll just tick the box. Okay? So again, think about who's coming onto the grounds, what they'll be doing, and what activities will be taking place. Once you've established your health and safety policy, you've got to make it visible. Okay? And I recommend that you put it on the wall of your club room, get it laminated, all right? Whenever you get new members come and join your club, include it in the information that they'll be provided with. And as part of this, and we've talked about this at board level and at the planning meeting, every person who is a member of your group should agree to abide by your code of conduct. And if you haven't got a code of conduct, I'd urge you all to get one. And there's many templates available, and ESNZ has a code of conduct. And one of those principles will be to abide by any policies or rules of the club. So that means if you deliberately breach a health and safety policy, you can be held to account to a degree. You could be censured as a member, okay? You may have some mechanisms by which you could do this or bring it to their attention and say, look, you know, just seeing you do, it may be that there are very, in addition to the rules under our dressage rules for schooling young horses, for example, lunging, you know, particularly at a practice day, you can get lots of people out there with lots of young horses. I've been at some events and there's been up to five people lunging young horses at the same time. And it is amazing how common sense seems to go out the window. And it's actually a high, high risk activity. And for those of you who are on the grounds, you're relying on the capability of the other people to manage that situation. So I would sort of say maybe have a think about some of those things. Have some maybe some rules around your particular sports ground. It may not even, your sports ground may not have the capacity to have more than one person lunging a horse at a time. Okay, so you need to think about that kind of thing. Most important message. So can you all, if you're writing any notes, this, in addition to establishing a health and safety policy and putting it on the wall, this is the one thing I want every area delegate to go back to their groups to do. I want a health and safety register, okay? You need a book. And when you run an event or have a club day, that everyone knows where that book is. And the purpose of that book is to register the who, what, when, where, and any action taken. Did something happen? If an incident arises, if a rider falls off their horse, write it down. If someone slips over in the toilet, write it down. Some things might be brought to your attention at a later date, might be brought up at a committee level, even if it's sometime after, get the details as best you can and write it down. Those kinds of books can give you such valuable information. I worked for a in-house for a time for a public liability company. And this was something that became critically important because it gives you really great insight into what's actually going on with your business. Now, one of the businesses I tended to do work for were big shopping centres, and so there'd be lots of people slipping over and falling over. So there are a couple of outcomes that would happen from this really comprehensive reporting of incidents. And we had these standard incident report templates. And one of the things I'd be responsible for would be taking those incident reports and keeping a record. And making assessments on whether or not follow-up was required. And we had an amazing ability to reduce the likelihood of a claim arising simply by picking up the telephone and talking to someone who had been hurt or suffered some kind of consequence. So it might be property damage, might not necessarily be physical harm, might be that something's arisen at one of your events. Picking up the phone and saying, "Hi, I'm calling on behalf of such and such club. I hear that you were at our event the other day and I've been told that da 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 happened. Just checking you're okay." And then you can have a discussion about what happened. Person might have some really good feedback. Okay, so there's a number of things that can benefits that can come from that. The other thing is you might see patterns arising, and something that you didn't think was a hazard actually is one, and you can actually start to think about doing something about it. Step four is getting guidance if you're unsure about how and what to do. I don't expect you all to be able to go away from this session and go, "Yes, I know what to do," okay? And so you're probably really lucky that you can have comfort in the fact that myself and Celine Philby are working together, going to be working together, Celine's shaking her head, no, to develop good sort of templates for health and safety for our groups, okay? But we will also be there to help give you some guidance. We're not going to have all the answers for you, but we're going to be able to give you some guidance. So at the bottom there, my email is there, and that's the best way to get me. Send me an email if you've got any queries, okay? So again, we're developing health and safety guidelines and policies, but I urge you, don't just take a tick the box approach to this. It won't be satisfactory anymore, okay? And so again, I probably sound like a stuck record, but it's common sense. Think about your group. Think about your environment that you're operating in. What are the capabilities of the people riding at your sports clubs? What are the types of events that are going on there? Are there other events happening at the same time you're running your event? Because there will be this also responsibility of, if you're sharing it, if there's cross-discipline things happening, you actually have a responsibility under the Act to engage with all of the other disciplines. So step five, don't put your head in the sand. Okay, don't ignore it. It's not going away. And I've recently been involved in a coroner's inquest, and I can tell you it's probably, of all the cases I've been involved in my career, it's probably been one of the most defining for me in terms of dealing with a family that has lost a loved one and looking at all of the decisions and all of the things that happened and led to an outcome where someone lost their life. And it really has you thinking about what it actually means. What does isolating risk mean? What does eliminating risk mean? What does minimising risk mean? And within that, the human element. We are not robots, and we will do things that are unpredictable. One of the things, when I reflect on that experience, and it involved a whole lot of things, but an environment that has large machinery, heavy trucks, that kind of thing, I realised that my experience of growing up in the country, on a farm, all of the things and experiences I've had as an individual, I've milked cows, I've ridden horses all my life, I've driven a tractor, I've worked on the farm, done all of those things, makes you realise that you actually have a really good understanding of risk and where to place yourself. And one of the things that I think is fascinating, and again in terms of the experience I recently had with this coroner's inquest, is that every horse event, we have massive vehicles reversing, going forward, arriving at the same time, vehicles parking up, horses being unloaded, children in pushchairs, people on the ground. It's all happening, and yet the one thing that being involved in horses gives us is an understanding of unpredictableness, of understanding your space, of understanding all of the factors that can impact on a certain outcome at a certain time. You lead that green horse off the float and you're looking around. You're thinking about the things that may impact on that horse's behaviour, where you're placing yourself and the steps you're taking to make yourself safe and the other people around you. We're really lucky. That gives us a wonderful head start in terms of this type of thing. But it also gives us an appreciation of the things that can go wrong, because I'd say every person in this room, even if it's just walking to work and checking your phone, has had near misses, and all of those near misses give us pause for thought, okay? So think of those experiences. And so the final thing I'd say is, this won't be just get it right and park it away and say, yes, that's done. You are going to have to review this annually, but also make a time whenever, and I hadn't put it typed up here, but this is another note I'd just like to encourage you all to do. When you have your area group meetings, can you include in your minutes, in your agenda, please, health and safety report, okay? And it might be that there's someone on your committee who is responsible for it, and they will simply report to the committee whether or not there's been any health and safety issues arise and if any steps need to be taken. So that's that as far as the formal part, but now I'd just like to ask if anyone has any questions. Celine?
Can I just share a story with everyone?
Certainly, yeah.
Many of you would have been at our roadshow, or at our roadshows last year, and probably recall me telling you about the health and safety policy at the AMP show that I run. Anyway, we did have a major incident last year where a bouncy castle left the ground with two children in it, blew on the roof of a shearing shed and then down the gully behind it. One child popped out at the top of the gully and the other child went to the bottom of the gully. So you can imagine it was a pretty tense half an hour. Anyway, we were fortunate that neither child was hurt. Our health and safety policy, which we'd spent quite a bit of time and money on a couple of years prior, was invaluable that day. I discussed with you all at the roadshow the importance of having a crisis management plan. We have two health and safety representatives on our executive. They knew what to do, they moved into action, we had a photographer, we recorded everything, we dealt with St John's, we dealt with the families, we dealt with the people. We had a press release out to the media on our website and our Facebook page within 2 hours of the incident to dispel any rumours, myths, stories made up about what happened. We had about 3 sleepless nights. We spent nearly a whole day preparing the documentation and the reports, submitted it to WorkSafe, and got the tick. If that incident had happened 3 years earlier, before we implemented our health and safety policy, and before we had a crisis management plan, I hate to think how it would have gone. So I can't stress to you how important it is to get this done, because I can tell you, when something goes wrong, it really galvanises everybody into action then. My executive committee care quite a lot about health and safety now, so make it a priority in your area, and I'm more than happy to help. I'm only a phone call or an email away, and as Genevieve said, I'm going to start working on a document that you can all use and update for your area group.
No, and I think I just also want to reiterate how grateful and thankful I am that we have someone of Celine's expertise and experience to help us on this new pathway. And that kind of experience is just so critical, because you want to make it relevant. What I haven't gone into in detail are the penalties under the regime, but it will be a criminal offence to breach the Act, and those officers will be in the gun, potentially, okay? But the organisations themselves can find themselves subject to a financial penalty, but also in terms of the media focus you could expect, the negative feedback that could arise from that. And so I always look at it from the other side. All of this is about creating a professionally run sports group, okay? If people know that they're part of an organisation that understands how all of this works, and that they're coming to an event that is well run, and if something does go wrong, that they're in good hands. That's really important. One statistic I hadn't told you was, in terms of the government's intent with this Act, one of the driving forces is that, as many of you are aware, that we have quite a poor record of workplace safety in New Zealand, and there are certain industries that are particularly poor. But the goal is to reduce workplace injury and fatality by 2020 by 25%. Okay, so that's quite an ambitious target. But these types of attempts at getting things tidier will actually help. It does make a difference. So any other questions at all? Yes. Well, that's a good question. So the question there is, if you're running an event in a ground that it's not your ground, it's actually owned by a different entity, they might have a health and safety policy. Can you be captured by it? Well, yes, you may do to an extent, but it's no good if you don't know what that health and safety policy is. So the first thing is, you want a copy of it. And I should think it might cover certain things that will be relevant to the running of your event, but I can also expect that there'll be things particular to your event which won't be covered, okay? And so it's making sure that you've got both policies there and that there is individuals or a group that have a very clear understanding of how they work.
I can report that I was at the Royal Agricultural Society conference yesterday, and guess what we had? A health and safety presentation. I think that you'll find that most of the bigger AMP shows and showgrounds have health and safety policies, but maybe not some of the smaller ones. So it's something you should probably check if you're hiring them.
Yeah, Kelly? It will be, in essence, safer to say everything that's under your control. But yes, because it's not just the workers, it's anyone else who you should be thinking about with their safety. So that's why I come back to that recommendation that if you are going to be running events, that you've got to think about who is coming to your events and what are their specific things that you may have to think about. It's remembering too, it's what's reasonably practicable, okay? Cost comes into it only at the end of the assessment, and that's kind of a balancing exercise. I mean, really, the cost is in time with this, for the most part. You've got really strong resourcing behind you in terms of expertise you can draw on, but it's going to be time with our kinds of events we're running, just making sure that you've actually got the policies in place. For industry, cost will be a different factor altogether. It will become more important because it might be about whether or not they install reversing cameras on all of their heavy work machinery. What's the cost of that? But then if someone's killed, run over by a reversing machine, was that a reasonable thing to consider? And in terms of our grounds, it might be the yarding. The yarding might have actually got into such disrepair that it's actually inherently unsafe. And then the question is, why was it not attended to? And the club may say, well, we don't have the resources available to do it. That balancing exercise will come about if someone's injured or hurt as a result of the yarding, and then after an assessment of all of the things, all the steps they should have taken, the question of whether or not the cost was a reasonable factor will have to be contemplated. But yarding is probably a big area. You know, you get someone who goes into the yard and there's a nail pointing out and the person's pushed by their horse and impaled on the nail and it's rusty and they get septicemia. I mean, that's the type of thing. Or that they get tetanus or something like that, or that they've need stitches because they've been injured on an old rusty nail. That's the kind of thing that you can think about. Yes, Linda.
Well, it's leading really on from the discussion around the facilities being made in the DC or the user of particular grounds. With regards to the handover of the information on the health and safety policy, guess there has to be a communication.
Yes. I would imagine if I was the owner of land and if I was advising the owner of land who was providing that land to be used by a sports association, I would want to know that they have cited my health and safety policy and that it becomes a requirement of their right of use. Okay? And vice versa. There should be, it's a joint of communication. The typical thing is the AMP showgrounds. But I would expect that if you're using AMP showgrounds or council land, that they are going to say, sorry, you can't use it unless you've got a good comprehensive health and safety policy, and that there is an entity that is accepting responsibility for the use of the land and abiding by our requirements for health and safety. Okay, shall we go here first? Yeah, and I'll come through.
If you're organising an event under the umbrella of an organisation that does have a health and safety policy organisation and riders gather at those grounds,
yes.
But the event involves you then riding on a public road.
Well, you could prescribe what might happen, because if you know that everyone's going to be riding on the road, put it this way, okay, a triathlon, okay? Triathlons are going to, there's going to be road cycling, all right? And so there's use of the public road, and it may be that even while the event's being run, there's people in their cars going backwards and forwards. The organiser of the event will be responsible to ensure the safety of everyone who's come to compete on that road, who's come to watch, and who's an official. So you will have to have a policy in place. And you have to make sure that particularly the officials and the competitors are aware of those guidelines. So let's take that to an example of your event and you're riding on the public road. I can think of hunting, okay? So you're part of your hunt club, and during the course of the hunt, to get from one farm to another, you leave the private farm owner's land and the meat travels along the road, okay? Good practice would be that in order to be a member of the hunt and take part in that hunt, that you've agreed to abide by all policies and procedures that the hunt prescribes. That would include a health and safety policy, and that health and safety policy would acknowledge that from time to time, riders during the course of a hunt will be riding on a public road. That when they ride on a public road, they must abide by the road code, which specifies quite clearly what your rules and obligations are for riding your horse on the road. And that if you don't ride in accordance with that, that you may be asked to leave the hunt for that day. But there would have to be someone responsible as well, from a practical point of view, that if someone observes someone riding on the wrong side of the road or not in single file on a single lane road, that there's someone there to say, hey, come on, that there's someone responsible for making sure that people are riding appropriately.
So you have to consider things like cars backfiring.
Oh, totally. And if you don't, and then, but also the other thing is that you've given everyone a briefing. That you might find that on that particular occasion you've got some people on young horses. It might be that making sure that before the event you've let people know that these are some of the things, and saying we would recommend that this is not something you should ride, if you've got a young horse or a horse that can't manage that type of thing, then you've really got to say, is it appropriate for those people to be part of that group? Because they could actually affect the safety of everybody else. It's a balancing exercise. I mean, that's just my response to that. That's just my thinking off the top of my head. But, greater thought on it might come up with a different answer. But it's just thinking about the environment, thinking about the people involved, thinking about the things that might happen. Okay. Alicia. Yeah. No, it is, and I think there will be a feeling that you've really achieved something that's for the benefit of the sport. I think. Sorry.
So the other thing that I have is I actually have a template as well.
Yeah.
That might be different than the one that you have, so you're welcome.
Yeah. Oh no, that's great, Alicia. That's awesome. Just looking at time, we've probably got time for a couple more questions. Betty, I think you were the next in the row, and then. Yes.
It's a shared, it's a user group, so there's a lot of different people that come in. Plus, on a Sunday, it's also a market event, so you've got public coming in, using it. We can't stop anybody coming onto the ground. And plus, we share with other things. At one point, there was a model airplane. But it's how we can't, and I don't know, and we lease from the council, so we can't stop them coming.
Well, you. Yes. Yeah. Well, it depends, because the first thing, the thing you've said there is that you lease the land from the council. So the first thing is you want to look at the terms of the lease, because under a lease you do have the ability to control the land to an extent. So that's the first thing. Look and see what the terms of the lease say as to how far you can control the land and what comes onto the land. You may actually have greater power than you realise to actually restrict entry onto the land when there's an event happening. The second is, if you have got limitations on your ability to do that, yeah, you've got to think of other ways to ensure you're taking reasonably practicable steps to not only ensure the safety of the people using the land, the riders and so forth, but also those members of the public that may inadvertently find themselves in a precarious situation, right? You know, taking their dog on a quiet Sunday morning for a walk, and all of a sudden there's a young horse right in that space. So yeah, it may be that signage is appropriate, or it may simply be as simple as putting a rope up to define the area, so that there is a balance between the different people who have a right to use that land. Look, we had an example with Nationals, for example. So just prior to Nationals, the decision had been made not to have dogs, okay, and it was set out in the schedule. Shortly prior to Nationals, we got some people coming in and saying, look, we really want to be able to bring our dogs. And they gave some quite compelling reasons why they wanted to be able to bring their dogs to the event. I have to say my legal hat was like, no way. I could think of so many things that could go wrong, and while I appreciated people wanting to have their dogs there, it is a constant balancing exercise. However, we then tried to find some middle ground by saying, okay, you can bring your dogs, but there are going to be some very clear parameters. Now, as it happens, where those grounds are, there are actually people who are members of the public who can actually run their dogs, so there's always the potential of dogs even that are not connected to the show coming in. But you have to think about when you say yes to those things, you do actually have to go through an exercise where you think, okay, what are some of the things that could happen? And I do, particularly, it's a national show, it's an elite show, We have very, very valuable horses at that event, but it's also a lot of people worked really, really hard to be there and invested a huge amount of time and money to be there. And so then you think, well, it's nice to have a dog there, but you're leading your horse along and all of a sudden a dog comes out from the ramp of a truck and gives the horse a fright, and then there's this kind of flow-on effect where the horse could get injured. Where does that all sit? I mean, that's not a health and safety issue necessarily. That's more of a public liability issue, and in terms of a civil liability issue, but it's kind of still part of that thinking exercise. Now, there was a question down the back. And look, and that's what I'd say, think about your particular ground. If the volume of yarding, and I think too about talpo, there's a, you know, it could, by the time you've got to the end of auditing all of those yards, something could have actually happened in the meantime. So again, think about that and have a pathway to make sure. So that's quite right, put it in the schedule. But also, you know, Debbie was talking this morning about people coming on to Taupo NEC to use those grounds, getting them to sign a policy, you know, a health and safety policy. And it would state in very bold things, please check your yard for any hazards. If you identify a problem, this is the person to contact. Okay, and have the process there. Yep. Yep, so we're done. That's the next, that's it. So thank you very much.
Jen, to say thank you very, very much. It's a very dry topic for me, and I know you all feel the same, but it's obviously something that we can't avoid now. It is the old thing, don't put your head in the sand, guys, but we are here to help you going forward. Well, thank you, Jen. I know you're passionate.
Don't read my email, sorry. I've got something.
I don't share her passion, I have to say, but while she's on the board, I'm quite happy.
Thank you very, very much.
Sorry, Kelly. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to find it. Here we are, developing. Oh, yes, yeah.
Okay, cool.
So you can put that down if you want.
Down in the front.
Into a pocket or something.
Oh, you've got a pointer. Nice.
Check it's still on.
So yeah, I'll take my phone out of my pocket. Still got some reflexes.
Just hook that on. You can just pull that cord down if you want, so it's not.
Cool. Oh. That's still for you. I think there was 12.
All right, guys. Thank you. I'm pleased to introduce to you all Dave Clarke. He's going to be speaking on developing performance cultures and environments, something that's very relevant to us in our sport today. So to tell you a little bit about Dave, Dave's been working in the coaching arena for the last 30 years. He currently leads the Coach Force team, who are in the business of developing coaches in the Bay of Plenty region. He's also developing the new Sport New Zealand Pathway to Podium, which is aimed at providing support for pre-elite athletes and performance coach advanced programs. He was the New Zealand National High Performance Squash Coach and the New Zealand Squash National Coaching Director, and he's worked with 9 world champions and 8 Commonwealth Games medalists. So thank you, Dave, and we look forward to your presentation.
Okay, thanks very much, Kelly. Can you all hear me? Cool. So first of all, thanks for inviting me along here today to present to you guys. And it's a great opportunity for me to come and steal all your thoughts and ideas, okay? So if Debbie will tell you if you've been to something of mine, you're not going to sit here idly and listen. You guys are going to be doing a lot of the talking and a lot of the doing here this afternoon. You always have to understand that the personal practical knowledge that you guys in the room have is the absolute critical thing. The knowledge doesn't stand here up the front telling you about your environments and your cultures. It's all within you here, and what we're going to do this afternoon is we're going to share a lot of that amongst ourselves. Right. So that was a little bit of my background, but you've already heard that. But probably the key thing there I would say is that over the years of being involved in the high performance sector and the community sector, the culture and environment is an absolutely key critical part of our sport and what we do every day. Okay, you'll notice obviously I come from the squash environment, so I'm not going to profess to know anything about dressage at all. Although I did make a little investigation a couple of weeks ago. On the right-hand side there, you'll see that's actually a picture of my niece. So, weirdly enough, my niece is in the UK performance program, or development program over there. So I thought, well, with this coming up, I'll put a call in and speak to Lizzie, my sister-in-law, who has got stables and works horses and is heavily involved in what you guys are involved in, and I'll get a bit of advice and get a few thoughts. Unfortunately, she wasn't in. So I got to speak to her husband. So a couple of things that I learned was that you don't actually need 3 flashy saddles for each horse. You don't need a rug for every season, as it were. He seemed to think that you need about 15 horses each to train and develop. And all of this, he told me, was very, very expensive and very time consuming. So I know that everybody in this room here puts a huge amount of time and effort into the work that you do. Okay, there's a huge investment on your part financially and through yourselves. So, I mean, we know that you're going to be passionate people about what you do. The objective of this afternoon is just to examine a few things. We're going to look at why culture and environment is really important, okay, in your business and in what you do every day. We're going to ask you, what does a good one look like? How do you develop it? And what strategies would you put in place to ensure that that's lived? Okay, those are the key questions that we're going to ask over the course of the next hour and 20 minutes that we've got. Now, we will be moving along at a bit of a canter through this, okay, because time will be pressing as we go through. But you guys are going to be pretty busy in the next little short while. So, why is it important? Why is it important? You have a culture whether you like it or not. And you'll see it in sport, you'll see it on the TV, you'll see it in business, you'll see it in your lives. You will have a culture, whether you like it or not. It's about how you influence it is what really, really matters, okay? You guys have to lead and drive the culture and environment that you're creating. So in your programs, in the work that you do, you guys are the leaders and the drivers of that, okay? Now, just for a moment, there's a couple of questions there that we're going to explore in just a moment. I'm going to get you to have a discussion. But it was in about 2006 when I realized how powerful your culture and environment could be. Now, we compete at the Commonwealth Games in our sport. We have a singles program and a doubles program. And over the years, we did pretty good at in the double side of things, despite our players not being quite as highly ranked as the players we were playing against. Now, we have to complete a massive review. We all love those, don't we? We have a massive review that we have to complete at the end of each program. And in 2006, our person that independently was doing this review thought, I'll ring up and write to a couple of the other coaches from the other teams to see what they thought. Which at first I was thinking, oh, I'm not sure about that initially, but it turned out that we learnt quite a lot from that little foray into the other camps, in that their perception of us as a group and as a team were that we were well prepared, well organised, a really tight group, that we had got everything in place. We had done all of the little things that our group was working together as one group. When we were playing as pairs, they were playing as one rather than as two people. And that the coaching group, the support staff, all of those folks were working in unison. They'd even had conversations with their own players who were coming to them and saying, why aren't we doing this? Why aren't we doing that? They were having those conversations with their own players. Now, the really powerful thing about all of that is that they actually said that they had to have conversations with their players because they started to play a bit more conservatively against us. They started to actually change their what they were doing on court because their perception was that maybe we'd prepared a bit better. So in terms of the power of that culture and that environment that's created or that's perceived by others, they're literally changing some of the things that they do, which allowed us to obviously compete at a higher level. We were very fortunate to, over that period, we've managed to get 3 golds, 3 silvers, and 2 bronzes out of that those campaigns. So a question for you guys now. When we're looking at performance, culture, and environments, if I walked into your place tomorrow, will I see a leader worth following? Will I see a culture worth belonging to? And will I see you doing things that are really worth doing? What I'd like you to do is I'd like you to take a minute now and I'd like you to have a conversation with the person next to you and I'd like you to say why you're a leader worth following. What's good about your... Why you're worth belonging to and what things you're doing that are worth doing. Have a conversation. Cool. Yep. Or your programs, your writing programs, your committees, your yep. So it can be any aspect. Okay, everybody. I'll just stop you there for a moment. It's always interesting to ask yourself some of these questions, okay? As I said, if I walk into your environment, will I see the behaviours and actions of leading? Will I see the culture of the group in the behaviours, traits that I see occurring, what they're doing? And what are you doing? When you think back, you've got programs, groups, committees, okay? Are you doing everything that's important? Yeah? Are we spending lots of time on things that are not important and not helping our group go forward to do the things that we want to do, to achieve what we want to achieve? What I'm going to get you to do now, a little bit later on, I'm going to give you a little bit of a scenario, okay, down track, okay. What I want you to do now, you've got a couple of little pieces of A3, so a couple of little pieces of A3, so no writing on the colourful paper yet. I know you all want to. I want you to have a discussion on your table around why your culture is important. What are the gains that you can get from having a good culture? What are the risks involved of having a poor culture? How does it influence your group, team, what you're doing, and what you set out to achieve? And what I'd like you to do is just elect a little chairperson on the table. That chairperson on the table is just going to stop you from telling lots of long stories. Okay? So not lots of long stories, lots of thoughts down on the paper, because you're going to need them in a little while. Okay? Why is it important? What are the gains and the risks? Away you go, folks. I'm just going to loiter around and have a little look as you go.
Loiter somewhere else.
Cool. Are you going? Girls are going well? Flying along?
Money.
It's funny because my experience of everybody that I've ever met in it is completely the opposite.
Really?
Yep. So generally down to earth people, hard working.
Yeah.
I think they associate horses costing a lot of money.
Yeah, which they do.
Yeah, they do, but I think that's where they get that misconception.
Yeah.
Everyone I met in the field is always down to earth and good,
how we dress too.
Good people.
As soon as we put the jackets on, people get quite
standoff
on that.
Yeah. That's. But,
because sometimes when you're competing too, you might look quite serious.
Yeah, like, yeah.
Because you're concentrating and you might come across as being a little bit aloof or whatever, but you're not. Yeah. It's like when you meet people right now, it's a totally different environment and it's not a competitive environment.
Yeah.
It's true too. It does bring out some interesting things in people. And there are some weird people.
I think people are better when they know the rules, when they know what's black and what's right, what's expected of them.
Okay.
That's good. Thank you.
Definitely do. Cool. Nice. Cool. It's all right. Just having a little look.
Are we on the right path?
Cool picture.
We feel a little cold.
Yeah, I thought so.
I feel like there's an epiphany coming out.
Yes, there is.
Well,
there is.
It sets the standard for the organisation. It's like a benchmark for culture. So if they've got a culture of drinking and smoking and boozing, they are not going to be a successful sports organisation. If they have a culture of high performance, training hard, not drinking, smoking and behaving badly, then they're probably going to perform a lot better. So for me, the culture of the organisation is probably the benchmark for its success.
Yep. That's a good definitely point. On the right track. Definitely on the right track there.
Yeah. Well, what's the next question?
You got to come 10 minutes ago. What are the gains and what are the risks?
Well,
she
just said the gains and the risks were then there.
If we use the Nationals as an example, the Nationals is successful because the culture we've created around the show is very strong. Okay, I come and all my volunteers want to help me.
The show goes on, and we
have a culture of getting on, working together. We're inclusive, and we're all working towards the same goal.
Yep. Cool.
So that's a gain.
Can you get more done like that, do you think?
What was that?
Can you get more done like that?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yep.
I mean, and I think that I've always tried to establish a culture that people have fun when they come and volunteer, that it's enjoyable. So I resource them well and enable them to do their job well.
So they get satisfaction.
And that rolls on to service that's delivered to the competitor. And my mantra is that we are there to do
Okay, everybody. I'm just going to stop you there for a moment. I know you might not be quite finished, as it were, in that respect, but I saw you all writing down some great things on your pieces of paper. So let's just take five or six from around the room. Why is it important that we have a good culture and environment? Why is it important? What have you got written down? Anybody?
Structure.
Provide structure, absolutely.
Sustainable.
Yeah, absolutely. We want it to be sustainable. We don't want the flash in the pans. We don't want to turn up. We're great for a couple of days, and then we're rubbish the rest of the time.
Develop trust, of which people can become vulnerable and then develop through
that. Absolutely. And this is a develops trust, and this is one of the key things. If we go back to cavemen times, okay, one of the key things that a human being needs to have is a sense of belonging. Okay? So you need to understand that it doesn't matter what you do, it doesn't matter what you say, it's how you make people feel. Okay? When you're developing that performance culture and you're developing your environment, who had sense of belonging on their pieces of paper? Cool. Lovely. Yep, absolutely. And anything else? Another one or two?
Expanding the range. So there's friendship, passion, and the belonging and being approachable.
Cool. It becomes more than just about dressage, about riding. Becomes a sense of community, develop friendships, relationships, all of those things.
Role modelling for the next generations coming up through the sport.
Perfect. Role modelling. Critical in terms of your sustainability, of your programs, those kind of things. If you've got somebody who's here and is performing and doing things that probably shouldn't be doing and not performing to the standard that they possibly could, that's what these other folks behind are going to see. Now, we'll just move it along there. So, what does a great culture and environment look like? What traits and behaviours would you expect to see? What's going on? If I walk in, what behaviours will I see? What traits? What are they actually doing? Okay, what's happening in your environment? Okay. Next discussion, make some notes. Critical. Cool. It's all good. Your handwriting's better than some in the room.
Oh, really?
I'm winning. I'm winning.
You can actually read it.
No, it's all good. Cool.
What traits and behaviours would we expect to see?
Yeah, you get a bit of crossover. Right, if somebody really wants to belong, they just naturally are loyal. You know, there's no question of going somewhere else. You know, I would want to walk into an environment and say, I'll look around, I'll look at your coaching, I'll look at the people around, what they're doing, how the rider's behaving, and then I'll think, I want to be here, I want to be a part of this. How do I get in? And that's the kind of feeling. Yeah, yeah, that's the inspirational part. If I walk into the environment and I see the coach just barking at the athlete, you know, I'm thinking, I don't know if I enjoy that. If everything's falling down around everywhere in the environment, I'm not sure about that. If some of the other folks are not looking after the horses maybe to the level I would think would be appropriate, I'm thinking, well, I probably don't want to be a part of this. Yeah, it definitely would be some of, everybody loves horses, you know. No, you wouldn't want to be a part of it, would you? How are we going?
Yeah, no, we've got some, let's have a look.
Cool. Lovely. Yeah, absolutely. These are important things, basically. Yeah. Very important things. Saying if I walked into your environment, would I think, well, that coach is behaving in the right way, the horses are well looked after, you know, I can see care, you know, is everything falling apart or people, right. you know, it's about, I want to walk in and think, I really want to be a part of this.
Yeah.
I want to belong. And that's a feeling rather than a, you know, oh, you sent me a nice brochure that tells me you're wonderful. But when I walk in, do I see
do
that?
Do you feel that?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to stop you there, folks, for a moment. Okay, well done. You've all been busy beavering away. So let's get a couple of examples of the kind of traits and behaviours that you would expect to see in a great environment. Absolutely, yeah. Transparent governance, absolutely. Yep. What else?
Motivation.
Sorry?
Motivation.
Yep, you want to see people that are motivated in that environment. Yep, absolutely.
You feel welcomed and have a solid base
Cool. Positivity and trust, two very key things, or absolutely critical things in developing those environments.
And respect.
And respect.
And no blame.
No blame, absolutely. Yeah, I think one of the key things, we talk about respect, we go into events where we have players that try to kill each other the rest of the year, and then they have to play together in the doubles when they've been trying to beat each other up on the world circuit for the previous 11 months. And everybody is different. Everyone in this room is different. We've all got our little strange nuances and things that we do that annoy other people, me included, particularly my wife. Seem to annoy her a lot. But what we have to be able to do is, be, if your culture is strong, there's the ability to accept those things and move on towards a common goal. So literally that's what we need to do. I had two players in 2002 who were basically been in the top five in the world between them. One of them been injured with an Achilles injury, and they had 6 weeks to come together before the Commonwealth Games to try and win a medal. And they'd spent the previous 10 or 11 years not necessarily having a fun relationship, should we say, because they're competing against each other. All the press wanted to know was about what was going on behind the scenes. That's all they wanted to know. But those two people were fantastic in setting aside the past, their individual differences, and deciding we want to win a gold medal. And that's exactly what they went out and did. Set those differences aside to ensure that we've got a great culture, a great environment, and do what we need to get done. So those behaviours that we talked about, oh! Yep.
This is Dressage New Zealand. This is what it looks like.
Cool. And I believe that because no one would stand up and say that unless they really believed it. Okay? So all credit to the group in this room. You know, that you have the ability, somebody to stand up honestly in front of everyone and say they believe that you guys have got a great culture. That's fantastic. Those behaviours are closely linked to values, and I saw on some of the sheets around the room that values were down there, okay? And those are these deeply held beliefs that we have, that we've been drilled into us growing up, and they basically guide everything that we do. They guide everything that we do in our lives. And those values, they support your vision, okay? For your program or your environment or your group that you have, okay? Now, I see a lot of people put down on paper what their vision is. They come up with this really fancy one. It's really clever, okay? And then they have some values underneath, and then they put that in a drawer and then don't ever bring it out again. I was with a guy a couple of days ago who was going into an organisation to help them with their culture. And when he walked in, there was a thing called respect. There was a word, respect, literally above the entranceway. And when he went and sat down with them and said, what's the issue, what's the problem? He said, nobody respects each other. He said, you better go and write DIS at the front there, in front of your thing, because disrespect is what you're seeing. And it's all very well to have these things, but you have to live them through your behaviours and your actions and strategies that you put in place to live them every day. I heard somebody say, as a coach, I need to go out and give 100% every session of every day. Okay? And that's what you need to try and do. It's not always easy, it's not always possible, but that is what you have to try and do. So when you get a vision for your program or your group, when you have a vision for that, you have to understand how it makes everybody feel. Now, you stood up and said about the culture here of this group. My sense is that everybody does feel good about New Zealand dressage. Okay? Are you inspired by these visions, by this vision? And do you believe in it? Okay? It comes back to making sure that it's about a feeling. Okay? It's about a feeling. It's not about what you do and say, it's about how you make them feel. So what I'm going to get you guys to do is to start the process. If I'm developing a program, and you guys will have some athletes, I'm sure, in your programs, in your stables, in your groups, and the coach leads that process, but they don't basically own the process. The athletes own the process. So it should be coach-led and centered on the athlete. So when we develop our culture, we get the athletes to decide what that looks like. It's not driven down by the coach to say, right, you've got to do exactly like this, because they won't buy into it. You have to engage the athletes in developing these processes, these visions, these values, these behaviors and actions that they're going to live. It's not something you can just write down on a piece of paper and say, right, you've got to do this. You have to engage the athletes along that whole process, okay? Or the people in your group or team. So I'm going to give you a little scenario now. This is where you get your colourful paper out, okay? Here's a scenario. You've got a group of 8 riders, okay, aged between 13 and 20 years old, all at different stages of development. All of them would like to get better, and they'd like to compete at regional and national level in the future, okay? What I'd like you guys to do, using your notes, is to create a vision from your program. So that's the notes at the top, the very first top one on your piece of paper. I want you to discuss and develop 3 or 4 values that underpin it, okay? And I want you to come up with 3 or 4 behaviors for each value. And because there's a couple of you, there's enough of you on the table, you can get some of you working on one and some of you working on the other to save time, okay? So the last part of that is you want to develop some strategies and actions. What action systems and processes will you put in place to ensure that it's lived? How are you going to live it? So it's going to look a bit like that, like your pieces of paper, okay? Based on your scenario. Okay, let's get to work. So you're just going to write on the post-its, you can whip them off and put them back if you want as well, girls. That'll be... You can... Yeah, you can take them off if you want and do it like that. Yeah, first one is the vision. You've got your... For your group, yeah, for that scenario, for your... Yep. Just to remind you, there's a set of values on your table on a separate sheet that you can use to help you with the values. So just in terms of, so the values will be things like honesty, and so just your sheet there, have you got your sheet there? So like you had trust and honesty and those kind of things.
Oh, so we're doing three values?
Yes.
One vision, maybe three values.
Yep.
And so the things that must give sort of tie into it, don't they?
Yeah, yeah. Don't get ahead of it. some sneak. So, yeah, so some actions, and that's some of the actions and things that you. Yeah, so would that be like a sense of community?
Yeah.
You know, because you can incorporate a few into. Yeah, you can incorporate that all under that. Yep. And then the behaviours that you might expect to see might be friendships being developed. You know, you might see people helping each other out, you know.
You've got dedication and commitment.
So is there some words or a word that you can use to encompass several of those aspects that you just mentioned?
Engagement.
Yep, so engagement. It all becomes part of being having a sense of
belonging.
And or what would you call the group as a whole? It would be your a sense of community. Yep. Which would incorporate friendship, enjoyment, you know, those kind of things. It could be. Community effectively could be, but you can break it down to, you know, just enjoyment and that if you want to. But
enjoy, so behaviour would be enjoyment.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's where you drill it.
But, yeah, so an important part of our community is this enjoyment. So we keep coming back to making sure that everything we do involves enjoyment. The other thing is
we want a sense of achievement, don't we? We want a sense of
achievement. We want to complete something with this group. So our third value needs to be related. We've got the idea of creating community. And trust is a good part of what we want. So we need to. You need respect for any of that to work.
Right, so I put that under trust. It's one of the behaviours that I respect you and no blame, sort of.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
No, so you accept, you would expect to see people respecting each other. You know, that's what you'd expect to see, people respecting each other. You'd expect to see the people behaving as if they're enjoying themselves.
Yes.
You know.
Yes. Now the other one I'd like to put up for you was this thing of always putting my best. I was going to say this be almost performance related because our main goal is.
That's cool. You're right, spot on there, folks.
Mentally and physically, then yeah. And the same with the horse.
But that's not
a value. That might be a way of getting it. It's not actually a value.
So,
what are the values that are going to underpin, I guess, this team that we're taking into account for people's
differences?
I don't know.
So,
we get a bit lost on visions and values.
That's okay. That's okay.
The yes or no. So 2,000 word essays.
No. So you've got team.
Yeah.
do you want me to come in into your program or organization and see integrity? Do I want to see you as, you know, as one of your values, integrity? So you're going to do what you say you do? You're going to do, you know, is that something? Do you want your group to have a sense of community? You know, which...
an individual, it's a sport that you do. When you're there, there's nobody to help you.
Yep.
When you're in that arena, that's it.
So
they need to develop their self-confidence,
self-belief.
Cool.
Is that a value, self-belief?
So it can be used as a value. It's probably more what you're talking around more is about their commitment. You know, in terms of what you're sort of telling me is that they've got to get in there, they've got to do it, they've got to be committed to what they're doing, and that's you know, is that, you know, if I walk into your arena and I see the group of riders, will I look and think, geez, they look really committed to what they're doing? They're doing, if you say to them as a coach or you know, right, we want to work in on this and I want you to try and do this, and are they going to be doing it, or are they just going to be so that comes down to their commitment. So if that's a value, when people come into your program, you want to say, you know, I'm you know, this, in this group, these riders are all committed. This isn't a group for people that want to just come along and not do what you need to do.
We talked before about we wouldn't want that win at all cost thing, so that comes back to like the welfare of the horse.
Yeah, you don't want that. No, that's exactly what you don't want. So, and if you're going to create an environment which is excelling, which is a good environment, they'll have to be committed to what they're doing.
Yeah.
You know, so, commitment's always a decent value to have in there. Yeah.
Two behaviours that will encourage teams to forward.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
So these
are our values.
So if they're committed, the behaviour, you would see that they're being attentive and trying to do what the coach has said they want them to do. Yeah. How are we going over in this corner? Cool.
We're a small but intense group.
Cool. Often the best.
Yeah. So we're just up to our behaviours at each value, sportsmanship. Well, again, I suppose that's, you know, helping each other and assisting each other as well.
Yep.
Through the process.
Yep.
So each of those values you want us to break down.
So a bit like the behaviours. So a bit like we just had next door with commitment. So basically, the behaviour we'd expect to see is that
turning up on time.
Horse is well looked after. Yeah. You would expect to see that if the coach, if they're trying to be taught something, that they're trying to implement what's advice has been imparted. Yeah. You know, those kind of things. Yeah. So they're the behaviours that you'd expect to see. So if I walked into a program and I saw the coach doing something, and then the coach turns and then they're like, oh, look, we just do whatever we want, you know, that would tell me something.
Okay.
It won't always be perfect, but... How are we going, folks? Oh, you guys are going great guns. Okay, so in terms of...
This is the value and these are the actions, to be honest, respectful.
Yeah, so basically here that might be, we got high level of personal values as such, that might also sort of come under a sort, almost sort of like that they're committed to what you guys... Oh, you got commitment over there, sorry, yeah.
So it's not quite right.
So I think in terms of here, this is like these behaviours, these are the behaviours we... So
yep.
When we say respect, how would we see that as a behaviour? in your environment.
Treating other people.
Yeah, absolutely.
How you would like them to be, how you'd like to be treated.
Yeah.
So are you saying that's
perfect.
The value?
So or no, so that's probably what you'd want to put there. So, and if it's honesty, you know, it'd be like, you know, doing what you say you do. So that, you know, you don't say I'll do this and then you don't do it. You know, that you're honest with people.
Yeah. You follow through with what you're going to say.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
A lot of people are gunners.
Yeah, yes.
A lot of gunners.
Procrastination, yes. You know, so those are the kinds of behaviours that you want to see in your environment. You know, so if I want to see people being respectful, and we've sort of said that, you know, you're going to see people being respectful to each other. How are you going to try and put that? What strategies are you going to do to ensure that people are respectful?
Well, you lead by example.
Cool. So that's one action.
Yeah, here we go.
That's one action to lead by example. So perfect. Yep. So, you know, because if I've seen in a situation where coaches, they're in an environment and then they get into one person, they're disrespectful, and then that person is that person, but everyone around is, you know, they say execute one and influence a thousand. You know, and but not in a good way, generally. So it's then looking about how you can get some actions into that, you know, how you're going to go about it.
So that's what we do down here.
Yep.
Who is aid riders?
Yep.
Go as a team or as individuals to that show?
We can be very specific.
Either or, in terms of, in your program as a group, if they're operating if they're coming to you guys every week and they're crossing paths with each other, working together, even if they've got to compete individually, the group can,
but it still makes a difference if they actually work in a group. If we have that, then we have to have a team coach even though if they go individually.
Yes, building, absolutely, yeah. Spot on, absolutely. And that's critical, and that's often the mistake that people make. They don't encompass everybody. They don't take everybody's knowledge and use that. And I'll just allude to that now, actually. Cool. Okay, everybody, I'm just going to stop you for a moment. Time is pressing. I'm going to let you come back to it just for another couple of minutes in just a second. As you get further down your page, you'll start to get towards actions and strategies, okay? How you're going to live it every day, okay? Now, a little example is that we had eight players in our group. So we had eight players in our group. We have a massive board with all the players' names in, split up into eight blocks. At any stage of any training session, any player or coach can write something in their athlete's box, which basically might be something about, I felt they put me under a lot more pressure here. I felt I was getting on top of them here. So we're using everybody's knowledge in the group, in the program, to provide feedback, because as a coach, we see stuff. As an athlete in your programs, they will feel stuff and think stuff. And you might think you know what they're thinking, but you definitely won't know what they're feeling. Okay? So you need to make sure that when you're working with your athletes there, that you're really cutting them into what you're doing and them having input. So we'd have this huge board, so everybody is inputting. It's not just the coach. It's just not the person up the front that knows everything, okay? Got to understand what they're feeling. The other thing that we did as well, we'd have one-on-ones with the athletes, and in the first 5 minutes of those, any other athlete could come up and sit down with us and again discuss with the other person in our group and reflect on how they think they're going and feel. So it's a really open, honest environment. And at the end of every training, we'd reflect on how they've lived the values that we had. So
For example, so one of ours was teamwork. So where, okay, you give me an example of where you worked as a team today. And we will go around the room, or go around the group, and they will explain back how they've lived these values on every session, every training session. Even if we break for 15 minutes, where have you shown it? Where have you shown it? Okay? And that those are a couple of the strategies that, you know, we use. How are you guys going to ensure that you live your values and your vision? Okay? Another 5 minutes, and then we'll wrap up. Good.
Write a feedback session.
We've also divided it into this row is about the horse, this row is about the coach, this row is about the team.
Okay.
Yeah, so that we're making sure that we build in respect for the horse's welfare, respect for the coach,
yep.
Respect for individuals.
Cool.
Collective.
Yeah, I'm liking it. Yeah.
We might, as we go through, we might discuss.
Open office is a really good policy down with the coach, that they, all of these team guys feel that they can just approach him at any time and he's going to listen to them. You know, and if he's in the middle of something that he's got to get out and say, look, I've actually just got to get this email off, but hold there 5 minutes and then promise you come in. So it's that thing of feeling like the coach is approachable and there for them. I mean, open office, I guess, is probably the easiest way to describe it.
Yeah, cool.
That's it, yeah.
Perfect. Open door policy, yeah,
yeah.
Absolutely.
So that probably comes a little bit under that celebrate success. So actions, yeah. How are we going to do that? So how would we give that praise? So or we would just say, you know, regular feedback.
Well, I think you want to be sure that people, if it is a group, tend to watch each other, not just so no one's interested in that one. So there is a strategy. I just go back a step though. Do you think that they are a group? It would be an idea to appoint someone in the group as sort of a little group leader, spokesperson, who will just make sure everyone is happy.
Because it's quite a young group, isn't it?
Yes.
And it's never mentoring older ones.
Maybe a buddying
system.
Cool.
To make them feel.
Because you did right, because they're different stages, and that's really why you just put that little spread of age in there.
Yeah.
Because emotionally and cognitively they'll be slightly different. 13-year-old and a 20-year-old is quite different. So potentially putting a buddy system in to, you know, around, you've got empowerment as one of the things, peer support and advice, buddy system's perfect strategy. It's really good. Spot on, ladies. Good. I like it.
You just got to get the medals now.
Yeah, it's a bit of work in between.
I know Commonwealth, so we'll do the Olympic ones.
Yeah, Olympics is cool. Yes. Nice.
Everyone gets to be the top athlete, but they kind of
you know, give everyone the resources, not because they spend too much of their energy, you know, yeah. Who kind of drops out and goes to the resources of the people who are through that, yeah. not
so the trick is yeah, I think you've got the ability there. What you want to see at the end of the day is all of those riders basically try and become the best they can be and create an environment where they can all thrive and nurture and feel a part of. I feel, you know, that sense of belonging. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And that is, you've got that down there, that personal action plan for each rider. Absolutely. You know, so we would have plans for each of ours individually, but then also as a group and as a team. So basically we'd have their individual strategy for their own sort of strengths and work-ons, as it were, so we don't call them weaknesses, note that. Okay, so strengths and work-ons. And then, because some things they're not pants at, you know, they're, oh, I'm still on microphone. On. Some things they're not so good at. but they can still be quite good at them, and they're just work-ons. They're just trying to improve those aspects. Yeah. So, you know, we would have an individual one for them as a pair, and then the team as a whole. So we've got three things going on: what they individually work on, what they do as a pair, and then what we do as a wider group. And then in a games program at the Olympics or the Commonwealth Games, you'll have the wider New Zealand team, which you have to consider as well. So you have another layer. And the culture that...
Talking on that harness call, which only has your, like, yourself and a piece of equipment, or are you talking about... What sort of sport are you talking about?
So any...
Any question?
Any sport. Yeah, any sport,
yeah.
You would need to try and develop, you know, the culture as a group. But within that, like you said, you've got here these individual plans for each of the riders. Yeah.
Just that I always find that hard when you've got horses to worry about, because horses are so different. If they're having a tennis racket or a golf club or a bike.
Yeah.
You've got to consider that side of it.
Absolutely.
And that's where I find it difficult.
So
every day's a different day.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways.
Yep, so the care of the horses would be absolutely paramount within your culture. You know, that everybody within that group looks after their horse to absolute top standard. That be part of your, you know, you call it husbandry, or is that what you call it? Management, horse management, or animal
welfare. It's really in managing, you know, like an athlete as much as a rider.
Yeah.
Even more so, really.
Yeah, absolutely. It's all part of it. And within your group culture, if you've got two athletes who aren't really looking after their horse very well, do you think the others will want to kill them? They will, won't they? And then that's going to create a rift, and then that's going to create drama and difficulties. And so everyone needs to be on the same page in terms of looking after the horse.
Especially with some horses, like you might throw your bike on the floor, and then of course the kids might take it out on the pony. You know, by losing their temper or throwing a paddy or whatever.
Yeah, so that needs to be part of your culture. So actions and strategies might be, you need to have expectations of, this is how you will look after your horse. This is how you will behave with your horse if things don't go so well.
Yes.
You know, and so... Yeah, so that needs to be laid out in your... So for any program that I do, I'll lay out the expectations of the athlete, the expectations of the coach, and the expectations of the parents before I do anything.
Yeah, and obviously you've got equipment.
And then we all know where we stand, yeah.
The parents is the tricky one, then. We haven't mentioned the parents, because there's a lot of parents in here.
I'll mention them now, actually, for you.
Yeah, because it's 13 years
old. So we run I usually run a parents' clinic.
You work parents' clinic.
Yeah, and I tell them, this is what you can do, this is where you can help, this is what you can't do, and this is where you can't help. They have to, because I get them to sign off on it. And then when they do something out, I can say, hey, you know, we said you can't do this.
Would be an example of a line that they're not to cross. Would it be like...
So that start trying to coach them when they don't have the knowledge to do that.
Yeah.
you know, saying, oh, you should be doing this, and this might go against what you told them, you know. Yeah, so, you know, so I set the line, and then you get the parents working for you instead of against you.
Yeah, because you get the argument without the parents
putting in, aren't they? It's like a...
Yeah, part of the team. Part of the team. Okay. Okay. Okay, folks, I'll stop you there. I'll stop you there if I may. It's been quite interesting going around the room as well and having some conversations about some of the challenges that you do face within your environment. Okay, and they're not dissimilar to, in most sports, what challenges people face. The only different challenge for you guys, obviously, you've got your horses to consider. Not everybody has those to consider as well. So just an example, as we've gone around the room a couple of times, was just around in terms of the behaviours that you might expect to see. You might expect to see that they have great horse management. That might be something that you expect to see in their behaviours. How are you going to set that in place? It's not necessarily just about, in your environment, just about obviously the rider themselves. Okay, so your environment needs to be all encompassing your horses as well. Now, you should have ended up with something similar to this, and I know we've had to go through it more of a gallop than a canter maybe, okay, because time is not on our side. But a couple of things I just want to talk about in a discussion we had on the table. Some of the things that we would want to try and have in your actions and strategies. So before I do anything when I devise a program or I'm running a program, I'd have expectations of what I expect of the people in my charge, expect of the athletes. I'd have what they can expect of me as a coach, okay? And I would have what I expect, my expectations of parents and their involvement. And that's come up a few times around the table. So to give you an example of how a strategy or an action, I run a parents' clinic before I start any program that I engage in. So I get all the parents in, I go through with them what they can do, where they can help, where they can't help, and I go through the kind of things that if they've got an issue, for instance, that they want to bring up, they can't bring it up before training, because before training I'm focused on the athletes and that is what we're there for. If they want a discussion, I'll make time for them after training is finished and they know that that's the strategy in place. So I don't get parents coming up to me at the start of training. And if I do, I can say, sorry, that's part of, you know, we said that we'll do that afterwards. So I can't, I'll see you afterwards. And they can accept that because they know it's expected. They know it's come up. So I get the parents to sign off on their expectations. So if there's ever any issue, I can say, hey, you said that you're not going to do this. Okay? So you can't do this. And it has to stop right now. And that way, you've got a lot more leg to stand on, as it were. And you can start to bring parents in as part of your group and your community. If one example that we just talked about over there was that, they might start doing some coaching. They might say, you as a coach might have said, right, we want you to be doing this and working on this. They might have got home and then the parent goes, oh, no, I don't think you should. I think you should be doing this, doing something else. Yeah? So you've got to put those expectations in place. And it's also engaging this wider community. Parents, siblings, business, friends, sponsors, getting them all on board with your culture and the community and the environment that you're trying to create. Okay? They're an important part because if they sit outside that community, they and don't have any information, don't understand what's going on, don't know what's happening,
they will start making their own stuff up. Okay? And then they will start causing problems. So you need to find ways of engaging that wider community. So like I said, a parents clinic early on, right at the start, to explain this is what you can do, this is where you can help, this is where you can't help, and this is where you can't go. And you sign here, please. Okay? And also by them signing, they feel part of it. And we come back to that sense of belonging that we talked about at the start. Okay? You need some systems and processes in place to deal with those things. And like I said, that's where you have them, signing off on the expectations, those kind of things. Need some consequence. So if something does go wrong, so for instance, I had a situation where we have our expectations and everything. We went on a trip to Australia. One of the athletes broke those expectations. We've got a process in place. If something happens, we're going to ring the parents. We're going to explain the situation. We're going to have a meeting to discuss what's going to go on. We're going to have an athlete with either, if the parent isn't there, they're going to have a support person. We're going to discuss it. And we ended up sending that person home on the plane next day. Okay? It sends a very clear message to everyone else in your group that your culture is a strong culture and what you say you're going to do is what you do. Oh, my kids will tell me off for saying do. You need to have some ongoing reflection in your coaching practice with the athletes. And I sort of alluded to that, you know, when you're working with them, talk to them, let them talk to you. Understand what they're thinking and feeling. As coaches, don't make it a one-way street, okay? And even as administrators as well, when you're dealing with the athletes, talk to them. How easy is it to fill in this form? Am I communicating with you in the right way? Yeah, all of those things. Let's talk to each other, make it as easy as you can. You need to try and make it holistic and embrace excellence on and off the arena. In the communication, relationships, with the national body, the regional body, all of those things. Okay? We embrace excellence on and off the field of play. So expectations, if you're going out somewhere, you're not actually in the arena, you're not on the competition side of things, you know, you're out that evening. Do they know how they're expected to behave? Yeah? Make sure they're in place. The other thing is your vision visual? Will I walk into your environment and see what you stand for around me? Will there be something? Will I see it on the walls? Yeah? Are we going to be constantly reminded of why we're there? Yeah? What our vision is? So that we're going to live it every day. We made up big signs. We put them inside the squash court on the walls. So in the back corners at the top, we put them on the glass, we put them on the board, we have on our headers of our, every communication that I send out, it's got the vision and values, literally, on every communication. It's at the top of every schedule, okay? It's easy cut and paste, okay? But it's visual all the time, it's constant, okay? And again, it was alluded to just over here earlier about having this open door, okay? Come and talk to me at any time. Don't go and talk to Fred down the road or Brenda around the corner. Come and talk to me if you've got an issue or a problem. And sometimes you might be really busy. And you might, but if you say, look, I'm really busy at the moment, just need to finish this, we'll come back to you in 5 minutes if that's okay. But I really want to hear what you've got to say. Okay? In your environment, you need to make sure you've got a constant open door. Okay. What I'd just like you to do now is I'd like you, there's some blue tack on your table. You're thinking, what's that for? What I'd like you to do now is one of you from each table to pop some blue tack on the back of your pieces of paper, and all the ones on that side of the room, I'd like you to blue tack them on the wall on there, on the other side. And you can go along and have a look at those. Take a picture if you like it. And then everyone on this side, I'd like you to pop yours up on this wall over here. Okay, so there's some blue tack there. And we'll and we'll finish up in just a second once that's done. Okay, this way you'll get a chance to have a look at what everybody's thoughts are, match them up with your own. You can have a little look when you get a moment. Have you not got? Where's your blue tag? There should have been. Is there any spare there? If anybody's got the extra piece of blue tag, there we go. There's some there. Okay, so a couple of last thoughts. You guys would have had some really interesting conversations, and you won't have all agreed on everything that you've put down, okay? Because it's cool. Consensus over here. So, because we all feel differently about some of these things. Some values might mean more to us than others. And as you develop your own programs and your groups of riders, you need to make sure that the values that are encompassed are true to the people that you're working with. So basically today you've been my athletes effectively. So you've been writing down what you think your values are and what you think the behaviours should be seen. And this is a kind of process that you can go through with your own athletes. If you had that group of eight riders, you can go through that process, get them to feed into that, and then they will buy into that. If somebody's written it down, if they wrote it down, then they're going to believe that much more than if you tell them what to write. Okay? So to get a good performance culture, to get a great one, it takes time to build. But it takes no time at all to destroy it. So that's why you have to live it every day. Okay? It's not a one day thing. It's not I'll just do it because people are watching me. It's like my kids with the washing up. Or I'll stick that straight in the dishwasher without rinsing it. No, you won't. That needs rinsing. It gets rinsed before it goes in the dishwasher. You know, when people are looking, you need to still be living your culture. It'll be tough. There'll be lots of people saying, oh, I don't know if I like this. I think you should be doing something completely different. And there'll be people from the outside trying to influence you to do something different, to do what they want. And it'll be tough. But so you're going to have to stick to your guns at times. Athletes have to own the process. We've covered that. They have to be the ones that devised it. It has to be lived and actioned. They're your strategies and your actions to ensure your culture is being developed every day. It needs to be visual. We need to have a constant awareness of it. So for New Zealand dressage, as I come in the room, I'd have loved to have seen something here that says who you guys are. You know, and then I know who you are straight away, what you stand for, what you believe in. Supporters, coaches and parents, you need to engage your community. They need to be part of it. Your athletes need to be self-responsible and accountable for their actions. Coaches, you have to learn to let go a little bit. Okay? Dictatorships don't generally work that well. Okay? There's usually one result at the end of that. It's usually the US invading you, but anyway. And we've put the posters all on the wall here. Take a moment there when you get up. I think is it tea for a second there? Take a moment to just have a look round. What I'm actually going to do now is I'm going to get my phone and I'm going to go around and I'm going to take a picture of all of your posters. And then I'm going to take those back and I'm going to learn from you guys today. So today is about me learning, you guys going through a process, having some discussions and understanding what you need to do to try and get a great culture within your groups. Thanks very much for your patience and thanks very much for your contribution to sport in New Zealand. Without you guys, it just wouldn't happen. So well done. Thank you. And that's the score you want. Aim high. You should recognise this score, everybody. Cool.
Thank you, Dave. I think we'll all agree that was a really worthwhile presentation. It was interactive, and I think we all got quite a lot out of it in terms of developing cultures within our own group. So thank you very much for your time.
Cool. Thanks very much.
Thanks very much. Back in here, ready to go at 10:02. Okay, for Nicola. Thank you.
Cool.
It's great being interactive.
Yeah, I try to make it interactive, basically, and get some discussion going and food for thought for everybody. That's knowledge is in the room,
and
that's
it. Some
yeah, and it's interesting. Dressage today at all, in that respect.
It was super, wasn't it? It was really good. Dave, as you go forward with these different sheets or charts, because what I thought would be really good is to actually then collate, or for want of a better word, I recognise individual.
Yep.
But with any themes, and then I thought that would be something that I could gather.
Yeah, absolutely,
for
yeah.
Dressage New Zealand around the composite of those, if there were any sort of themes or commonalities.
Because
I don't think I'm going to get it.
Is it not quite?
No, just because we've got biro.
Okay.
On that. So are you taking them from here, Dave?
No, you guys can have them.
Okay.
So basically.
Sure. And then we can feed, then I'm happy to share that.
Collated. Yeah, absolutely.
I'll do it at the end of the day. I'll take them and then we can. I'll leave
them
up to later.
When we come and tidy up, I'll put them together and make sure you get them.
Yes, and I'll then collate them and see if there's any themes.
Yeah, well, you absolutely.
Individuality, if that makes sense.
Yeah, but you might get some really useful information around the shared things, So I think the key today really was I'm just trying to get people to think about, what their environment's like, what goes.
Hello.
My stick's in the back there. I probably just need to unload it.
I'd just pull it out.
I do?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, just
put it there. Yeah, it's not my computer. So I'm like, oh, yeah, well, it didn't do anything. There you go. like, it goes.
Maybe hold it down. I don't want to be yelling.
Good dog.
Nicola Smith. We're very lucky to have Nicola as part of our local dressage group, so we're incredibly lucky here. So Nicola is a health and wellness expert, having been in the wellness industry since 2002. She runs her own business, which is an online business, helping members improve their health, fitness and wellbeing through nutrition, exercise and meditation programs. With the Ask the Expert column in Good Health Choices magazine, Indulge magazine, and published articles in New Zealand Herald, Yahoo Lifestyle, Women's Weekly, and Mind Body Green, Nicola is a source of refreshing advice that cuts through the noise of diets, fads, and quick fixes. Nicola is a qualified functional diagnostic nutrition practitioner, a Czech practitioner, and has a degree in physical education, and early on in her career was a Les Mills group fitness instructor. This unique mix of knowledge and practical skills allows her to guide those who want to achieve lasting health. So welcome, Nicola, and we look forward to what you've got to tell us and show us, no doubt.
Cool. I'll grab the mic. You may have just heard the group fitness instructor bit, so guess what we're gonna do to lift a bit of energy just to get us feeling good? Because do you know what's better than coffee and chocolate in the afternoon? And it's not wine. Because I know I heard a few people just going, oh, I feel like a wine about now. So I'd like you all to stand up, please. You don't need heels right now. So what I'd like you to do is just take a big reach really high up in the air, and I just want you to breathe out and go, ha! Beautiful. Do that again. Just breathe in and just go, ha! I can hear myself, but I can't hear you. So I want you to get really loud. I want you just to let all of the ego get some room around you, and I want you to bend over this time and go, okay, let's do this in time. I'm just going to do three of them, okay? So breathe in. Breathe in. Breathe in. Beautiful. You can take a seat now. Okay, so I'm going to be discussing all things fitness and nutrition. I'm going to start off with nutrition, but the reason I just did that is because it's really important to understand one of the best ways that you can build energy is through movement. And we're all been sitting for a very long time, and so that was just a beautiful demonstration of how you can just lift your energy up. So I'm gonna get rid of this. Okay, so I want us to become dressage athletes, and for a lot of people this might seem like a very foreign concept. And I am truly passionate about us realizing that we can be athletes. We put all of this focus into our horses, and you won't have to look far to know somebody who knows what's in their soil, what type of grass is growing, all of the supplements for their horse, the exact feed regime that they're getting on their horse, so they're balancing out the perfect behavior of their horse to the perfect training schedule for their horse, to the downtimes, to the hacks, to the making sure they're getting the movement into their horse, yet that same person is just grabbing food on the go and eating whatever is possible. Sound familiar? Beautiful. So we need to start taking this concept of what we do, and a lot of people put it into a hobby. We consider our role in this, almost like a hobby, and we're not putting this persona on ourselves that we are actually athletes as well. We're a team effort, and if we want our horse to shine, we have to be shining on top of that horse as well. So I want us to be taking just as much care of our own health as we are our horse's health. We are what we eat. Every single cell in your body is built by the food that you eat. Within 28 days, your liver will replace itself, the skin will rebuild itself, your body is literally becoming something from the food that you're delivering it into it. So if you're not providing your body with the nutrients to build a really healthy body, this is going to affect your energy, your mood, your emotions, and ultimately your long-term health in the as you go down. So just as much as you are what you eat, we are also how we move our body. What we put our body into every single day has an equal opposite effect as much as what food does. So the environment that we're putting our body into affects our body at a cellular level as well. There is massive studies these days about the negative effects of sitting. And I don't mean to tell you this kind of news when you have been sitting all day, but a bit of a shock. But sitting for long periods of time, over around 3 hours, and the average person's job is 8 hours, can have huge negative effects. And this is effects like heart disease, osteoporosis, diabetes. It's having huge effects on our health. And just through, I'd like everybody to raise their hands for me, and I'd like you to keep your hand up. See, everybody's hands are up. If you sit for longer than 4 hours today, not including today, if you sit in a job for longer than 4 hours per day. Awesome. Okay, cool. The supermarkets we go into are getting us more and more confused as to the type of food that we're eating. We're surrounded with conflicting messages as to what is the exact sort of food that we should be eating. Things that are saying they're natural aren't natural anymore. Things that are telling us that they're healthy aren't healthy anymore. And part of what I want to share with you today is just to get rid of all of the confusion. I just want to set you up with tools, no matter if you're starting out in dressage, if you're not even riding, if you've just got simple tools so you can help yourself get healthy, you can help your club get healthy, and so that you can help your members and yourself just to really shine as a dressage rider. Because I personally want to be riding on my last day on earth. I want to be riding, you know, galloping down a paddock, although I'm a bit scared to gallop on my horse, she's but you know, I want to be on that horse's back on my last day, and I want to be making sure that I am healthy and I'm doing everything I can to stay healthy throughout that time. Now, I'd just like to first get to know a little bit about you guys. So first of all, who here has been on some kind of diet in order to lose weight? Okay, cool. Who here would never ever like to diet again and would like to be at an ideal weight? Okay, who here would never ever like to diet again, like to be an ideal weight and would like to eat chocolate along the way? Okay, so food affects us, and I love chocolate. I have been munching out on some chocolate out the back there. But my chocolate is very different to the type of chocolate that you will be seeing in the stores and that a lot of the chocolate that is out there today. So we want to be making sure that we're providing our body with the food that builds us incredible energy, incredible emotions, so we're a happy person to be around, because food literally can affect you within seconds. It has the power to heal you, it has the power to build amazing energy, but it also has the power to do the opposite as well. And so when we start to put real importance into our health, we can really start to pay attention to what we're doing as well. And so food, we are what we eat, but equally important, we are how we digest our food. So you can eat all the supplements in the world, but if you haven't got good gut health, that's going to be affecting you as well. So we want to make sure that just as much as we are eating the really good food, we're digesting it too. And so this is just a demonstration of everything that's get affected when we aren't taking care of our gut health as well. A pretty common scenario in the supermarket. Most probably on, even if you go into a petrol station, the type of food that we are getting delivered to us. And so one of the best ways that you can make sure that you're taking care of your health is to just to start looking at ingredients. Just to start looking at exactly what's going into your body. Okay, so my chocolate that I've been eating is coconut, raw cacao powder, and dates. The chocolate that you get in the supermarket is not that. And I'm going to explain a lot about chocolate so you can get a really good understanding of a whole philosophy of how you want to be looking at your food as well. So this is what we want to be avoiding, is those massive ingredient lists, because this is going to affect how we sit on our horses, because it's going to affect our moods, all this kind of stuff. It affects your body at a cellular level. And throughout this time as well, I just want you to let you know that you're going to be able to ask me lots of questions at the end. So if you are getting questions that are coming up, you're going to have heaps of time to do that too. So, who feeds their horse magnesium? Who knows the importance of feeding their horses magnesium? Who feeds themselves magnesium? Okay, cool. When we are getting a diet that is rich in real foods, we're getting the type of nutrients that our body needs into us. When we look at chocolate and we look at the type of foods that we're eating, chocolate comes originally from cacao, so raw cacao powder. Raw cacao powder has over 300 compounds in it. It has enzymes in it, it has minerals, and it has nutrients in it. When it gets treated, it turns into cocoa, and that literally strips its nutrition. Then it goes into chocolate, and then all the ingredients get delivered into chocolate. So here we are, craving chocolate, but the reason we're craving chocolate is because we're craving magnesium, and we are reaching for the chocolate, but we're not even getting delivered the magnesium in the first place. Yet we're feeding our horses really good quality magnesium. So something as simple as magnesium comes from real food. And this is what we want to be getting into our bodies. We want to be getting rid of the processed foods, because when you start to eat real foods and you start to get delivered the nutrients, you start to get the energy. If we aren't getting the nutrients, we crave the sugar, we crave the wine, we crave the whatever else, and that's what we reach for. But when we start to fill our body up with real nutrient-dense food, this is when the cravings start to disappear, and this is when we start to get healthy, and this is when we start to be a much more healthier rider, and we're turning up to improve each and every ride. So raw cacao truffles, they look pretty good, don't they? Himalayan salt. 72 minerals inside it. When we have a diet that is packaged full of processed foods, this is getting more and more salt into our diet. Salt alone, table salt, has two minerals in it. It has sodium and it has chlorine. When we are eating all processed foods, we're getting too much of this kind of stuff into our diet. But when we strip that out and we eat really clean, good quality food, and when we start to add in things like Himalayan salt, we are getting the minerals back in. And the whole thing is we're trying to add minerals into our diet, because as soon as we eat the processed foods, we are starting to affect our body at a cellular level. And so you're constantly seeking out for more nutrients. You're going to become a nutrient hunter, and that's the choices that you start to make with your food. And so when it comes to things like salt, that even the water we're drinking today is affected as well. And so water today can come in lots of different forms. And I want you to imagine you're a caveman and you've got this spring out your backyard, and this water is pumping the spring water out to you, and you're able to drink straight from your spring. Some of you might even actually have a natural spring on your farm. But this spring water has the minerals inside it. As soon as we drink tap water, as soon as we drink filtered water, it gets stripped of all the nutrients. And the problem today is we're getting more and more nutrient starved, yet we're eating more and more than ever. And so when we start to look at, again, adding the nutrients in, this is when it starts to improve our health. Because we're more and more tired, we're more and more busy, we're turning up to their horses, and everything gets affected to them as well, because we know how responsive they are. So we want to be turning up when we ride, feeling great, and with the energy, and again making sure that we can keep riding until we're we really want to. So you are what you eat. Every single cell in your body is built by the food that you eat, and you are when you eat as well. Common scenario, getting up in the morning, skipping breakfast, maybe having some coffee, maybe a piece of toast, then getting through the middle of the day, getting through to the evening, and then eating the bulk of your meal in the evening. Pretty common scenario. Melatonin is produced in your gut. Your melatonin is what makes you recover and what makes you sleep and what makes you repair. In between the hours of 10 p.m. and 2 a.m., your body physically repairs itself. And in between the hours of 2 a.m. and 6 a.m., your body psychologically repairs itself. So if we're eating our meals really late, our body's still digesting its food, we're not able to produce melatonin, we're then going to bed late, we're waking up to an alarm, or waking up late, and we're feeling groggy, so we reach for the coffee, we're then reaching for the sugar throughout the day, and we repeat this vicious cycle. So the timing of your meals has a huge impact not only on your weight, but on your energy, on your hormones, on everything. So the timings is really important. You want to structure your day so that you're getting food to fuel you for your day. We're eating breakfast. Breakfast is nutrient loaded. We're getting lunch, and the smallest meal of your day should be one that's easy to digest and that allows you to calm down so that you get a really good night's sleep. So then you're bouncing out of bed in the morning and you're able to set up a really positive next day. You are how you move your body. So like I said before, every single cell in our body gets affected by how we move. Our body starts to shut down when we sit for too long. 50% of your body isn't working when we're sitting. We burn 50 more calories when we stand. When we structure our day, for a lot of people it can be really hard because you're looking at like your office job, or you might be looking at your scenario that you're currently in, but simply by breaking up, you know, a couple of hours by standing can make a huge difference to the kind of metabolic changes that happen in your body as well. So it's really important to make sure that we move. And so no matter what, you want to start with a solid foundation. And whenever I help people with their nutrition and with their fitness, it begins with a foundation. Because if I was to turn up here and tell you all to head to a gym, you've got to go to a gym 3 days per week, and you've got to spend an hour there, and you've got to get a personal trainer, and we've all got absolutely no time at all, and we're all just too busy, and the thought of exercise is just, it's just not for me. So it begins with a solid foundation, and that solid foundation starts with moving more. You want to start to aim to spend 50% of your day moving. And for horse people, and particularly if you've got more than one horse, this can be fantastic because you've already got something there. If you've got a dog, that's fantastic because they're telling you that they need you to go for a walk. But if you haven't and you're in an office situation, that's when you want to start to look at that kind of thing. Because when we sit, this is what happens to our body. Our hip flexors get tight, our posture gets tight, our digestive system closes up, everything gets affected. So can you see what this person would be like riding a horse? So we want to make sure that we're really open and we're strong and we're doing everything we possibly can to improve our riding off our horse. And sitting for too long a period is going to affect your hip flexors, it's going to affect your Achilles, and that day when you're 70 and you're still wanting to ride and get your foot up, it's going to affect you hopping up on that horse. So we want to make sure that we're constantly keeping our range of motion and our whole body healthy. And we're going to be going over this soon, so you're not going to be sitting for the entire time, so I'll just give you a bit of warning. You are also how you sleep. So, like I said, we want to make sure that we get that 8 hours of really good quality sleep. And the light that we get into our eyes affects how we sleep. And so if we're in a scenario where we're inside all the time and we're not getting out on our horses, it's going to affect the quality of our sleep too, because light coming into our eyes, this sort of artificial light today, can affect you. But just before I go any further, how many horses is everybody, sorry, raise your hand if you're just riding one horse. Okay, raise your hand if you're riding three or more horses per day. Cool. Just so I, and How many of you are in like an office job? Cool. Okay, thank you. So when we are in this kind of light, we've got the hormone called cortisol, and cortisol is something that comes into our body when light stimulates ourselves. And so if we're in lights like this all day, we need to make sure that we're getting light from the daylight into us, because again, this is going to be affecting our sleep at night. And the reason all of this is so important is because this is what helps us have energy and motivation. And this is what, when we wake up with zest for life and thriving for life, this is when we're going to want to get better at our sport and improve in our sport. But when we're dragging our feet and we're dragging our toes and we've just got to get to work and we've just got to do this and we can't do, you know, it's just this constant cycle. And my goal is to help everyone just realize their true potential and help you thrive as, whether it's thriving as a rider or thriving as whatever sport that it is that you're wanting to do. So just as much as you are how you sleep, you are how you digest as well. So the food that we eat, we've got to make sure that we're able to digest it. So every single thing is connected in our body. Too often we treat things separately, so we might be treating nutrition separately to the way that we move, but our body is everything connected. So what we eat, how we move, how we sleep, how we digest. And it's all about making sure that we're starting with that real food basis. So nutrition 101. Become a nutrient seeker. We're looking for food that is based off whole, real food, making sure that we're avoiding the packaged foods and we're shopping around the outside edge of the supermarket so that we're getting the energy and the nutrients into our body. So eating whole, real food. Food that your grandma's grandma used to eat. You're filling your pantry up with one ingredient produce. So what do I mean by that? Going to the supermarket and you're like, okay, I feel like some lemon honey stir fry. So you go to the supermarket, you pick up and you see all these lemon honey stir fries and they're all packaged. You look on the back and the back says that list of ingredients that I showed earlier, right? Instead, you go to the vegetable aisle, you get lemon, you get honey, and you get ginger. The real whole ingredients. That's what you fill your house up, that's what you fill your fridge up, and we get rid of the processed foods because this is what's going to make us thrive. Who's confused about what they should be eating when it comes to, you know, should I be going low carb, high carb, more protein, high fat, should I be eating in the evening, should I be skipping meals? Who's confused about food? Okay, when we eat in this way, it's about eating when you're hungry and stopping when you're full. It's that simple. It's about listening to your body and not listening to the media, not listening to that natural food product that's sitting on the supermarket shelves. It's simply going, okay, my body needs real food. I'm not hungry right now, so I'm not going to eat just because it's 6 o'clock. I'm not going to eat because it's this time or because other people are eating. I'm eating simply because my body needs fuel right now, and it needs real food as fuel. And that's as simple as it gets. We just start to trust our own instinct and we start to eat the real food and delivering those kind of nutrients to it. And so then you stop when you're satisfied. So it's chewing your food, digesting your food, sitting down to eat. When we eat on the run, our sympathetic nervous system's going, so that's our flight or flight response. We know what that kind of looks in a horse. Their eyes are out like this, and they can't. As soon as you do that, your digestive system doesn't work. It's not designed to work when we're running away from a tiger. And so when we eat on the run, that our digestive system doesn't work. So then we eat, and we're like, can't remember if I've eaten. Then we're not getting the nutrients from the food, and then an hour later, we're craving something else, and it's usually that something else is something we probably shouldn't be eating. So when we stop to eat, our body's able to actually get the nutrients that it needs from those foods as well. And then again, taking care of your digestion. So making sure that you're eating the foods that, and you're chewing your foods and the foods that your body's designed to eat. Our body is really good at doing what it needs to do from real food. As soon as we add these other things into it, like the additives and preservatives, this is when it gets confused, and this is where we start to show other things start to sneak up. a really simple way to look at it. And too many people were afraid of the kitchen, like just afraid to get in there and start enjoying the food. And it really is one of the best things that you can possibly do to make yourself feel amazing. It has the power to heal you, it has the power to energize you, but it also has the power to do the complete opposite. And even if you don't enjoy the kitchen, telling yourself that you do and faking it until you make it is a really powerful thing. It's the more you get in there and the more you start to get creative, the more this is going to have a huge impact on your health. And so it's just putting in the effort and just making the time to do it. And it doesn't have to take a lot of time. You know, once a week preparing a whole lot of food can make a really big difference so that you can spend more time out on the horse as well. So that was all about nutrition. Has anybody got any questions just covering off any of that? Okay, cool. Yeah. Yeah. Baking is fantastic. Like, baking is great as long as it's coming from real food. And it's the baking that's, like I said, the ingredients are changing, that what we're getting delivered to us. And if you were to go buy a cake from a supermarket, that cake's going to be completely different to the cake that you would buy or that you would have made at home. So that's the difference, and that's what's changing. So when we look at exercise, horse riders are active, and that is one of the greatest things. And any horse rider I meet, they're generally out there, they're doing it. But they also put off this thing called exercise as well. But the thing is, it's not just, it's the confusion that's relating to exercise. And so when we look at movement and exercise, often we put them into the same category, and they're not. Exercise is something that we often put over here, and it's something that involves a gym, it involves some workout gear we most probably never ever want to get into, we'd rather be in our joppers, and it's just something that we just never ever want to do. Then there's this thing called movement, and movement is generally what our riding comes into, and this is something that involves, you know, walking, standing, sitting, just generally moving our body. We are designed to move. And the more that we don't move, the more that our body changes. Somebody who exercises for 1 hour, 6 days a week, going to a gym, a high intensity workout, can spend the rest of their day sitting down. That person is still classified as sedentary. 4% that person would be spending, 4% of their week in a gym. 1 hour every single day for 6 days a week. 96% of their week is spent sitting. That same person could be spending 1 hour, 6 days a week riding their horse. 96% of their week could be spent sedentary. That's having a huge impact on your health at a cellular level, at a postural level, at a digestive level. Can we see how this all kind of starts to unravel? So it's not just about how we eat, it's also about how we move our body as well. And so we want to start to look at what we're doing each and every single day to make sure that we're keeping our body mobile and active, because the more we sit down, the more this affects our health. So a really good aim is to make sure that you're starting to spend 50% of your day standing. Or standing or moving. So that's where you could be, if you've got horses to ride, it's the best thing in the world because it's going to keep you moving. If you've got a dog to walk, it's the best thing in the world. If you've got an office job, you spend some time standing up, you get breaks, and you're just making sure that you're moving. Just putting in some breaks every, you know, 2 hours is enough to reverse those kind of negative effects that can happen in your body. And so this is what we want. We want to start to look at how we're spending our day so that we can better improve our riding. Because we don't want to be the weak link in the chain. So we have... The majority of us are having to work really long hours so that we can earn the money, so that we can do this sport that we just love so dear. And it involves a lot of hours of dedicated time. But because we're so passionate about what we're doing, I don't want that to hold you back. So you're constantly thinking about, okay, what can I do each and every single day to improve my health so that it can improve my riding? Because I can improve my riding off my horse. So just as we sit there, I just want you to put one hand on your sternum and one hand below your belly button. Okay, so we're going to set up neutral spine. So neutral spine is how a good dressage rider would be riding, good posture, everything would be connected. So neutral spine, you've got your hands parallel like this, and if you were to, if somebody was to say shoulders back, head up, your hands would split and you'd be like this and your core would all be exposed. If you were collapsing, and how a lot of you were sitting just before, they would be like this, they'd be closed up. So I want your hands to be parallel. I want you to like brace in your core, so it's braced and it's strong. And I want you to put a smile across your collarbones and then almost peel and open your shoulders. And now just breathe and relax. Now I want you to hold that position while you just think of that neutral spine. So there's certain things that you can start to do in your day-to-day life, how you can improve your riding. So when we were all sitting there before sort of falling asleep, even when you're driving a car, what's this doing to our seat bones when we're sitting on the horse? So there's little wee tweaks and reminders, and it could be the simple fact that for an hour of the day you sit on a Swiss ball, or that you're standing up and doing those things. So we want to make sure that we've got this neutral spine on. Can we feel the difference? Some of us got it on. A few smiles. So this is a really powerful way to start to look at how you spend your day. So now I'd like you to stand up. Okay, there's certain movements that our body's designed to do, and too often we lose these different movements, and in order to be a really stable, mobile and strong rider, we need to make sure that we've got good range of motion and that we keep our range of motion, because it does involve things like when we go step up on, when we're hopping up on the horse, or when we've got to lift a hay bale, or we've got to do things. We've got an active lifestyle when we have horses, and so you want to make sure that you're keeping that body strong. So when we have a neutral spine, and we're standing here with our neutral spine, and it's all braced, your body is actually designed to be able to squat all the way down here. And we're designed to be able to come all the way back up. So we're going to do a little test and see how our body is. And I know you're going to be looking. So all we want to do is have our feet parallel. But don't panic. You're just going to go to where you can, even if it's here. But I want you to hold your neutral spine. Because when we come down, we might arch like this, and again there's little things you can do to improve your riding off the horse. So when you go to sit down, you're keeping your neutral spine. So imagine this where we were before, and even if you just sit down on the chair and come back up, just do where you're comfortable. But if you can and you want to explore, come all the way down, but you're keeping your neutral spine. So you want to imagine you've got a seat that's way back there. And you want to push your bottom all the way back. Cool, and we're smiling through our collarbones, because remember, as riders, we don't want to be arching like this, so you're keeping everything open. Smiling through the collarbones. If you want, bring your arms down, just holding that neutral spine. Okay, cool. So your first move that your body is designed to do is squat. So that there was a simple squat. And we want to make sure that we move our body in its natural way, because as soon as we don't, we start to limit its range of motion. So a simple thing is a squat. And we do that every single day when we sit on a chair and when we hop off a chair. The next thing your body's designed to do is a lunge. And all I want you to do is step one foot back. And again, holding your neutral spine. So you want to set up your neutral spine, shoulders back, smile through the collarbone and through the mouth if you like as well, because you're enjoying this. And just locking in, and you're just going down to where you feel comfortable again. And just lifting up. And your body is designed to go all the way down. So your knees designed to go down to the ground, and things will happen. Things will happen. You might tip forward, you might lean back, you might find that one leg is weaker than the other, or you feel unstable. And this is a really powerful indication of your body, and because when we've got tight areas, this is going to twist us on our horse as well. So switch it over to the other side and try it again with your neutral spine. You can put your hands on your hips if you like. And remember to breathe. I'm seeing lots of tension and stress up here as we concentrate. Cool. Okay, you can have a seat again. Awesome. So when we ride, if we have got a tight area, like if we've got tight, if we sit on our chair like this, what's happening to this hip flexor? Yeah, you're going to twist your pelvis. So what are you doing when you hop on your horse? What's happening to one seat bone? If you've got a horse that's always leaning on, it's one rein, or a horse that, you know, it's got its own mind there, but you're constantly, you know, trying to push it the other way. Our body and how we spend our day-to-day life affects exactly what's happening in the saddle. So when we lunge like this, if we've got one side that feels tight or unstable, there are things that this your body is telling you that's going on with your body. There are areas that we want to work on to improve that balance and that strength. And it doesn't matter where you're starting at today. You could have found that really easy. You could have found that really difficult. But your body is designed to squat. It's designed to lunge. It's designed to push, pull, bend, twist, and walk. So when we sit like this all the time, all we're doing is bending. Our body is in a bent position. So if this body was then to go hop on like a spin bike, they're still in this kind of position. Then they go sit at their desk and they're still in this position. Then they go sit in their car and they're still in this position. Then they go hop on their horse and their instructor tells them, pull your shoulders back. Can you see what's happening? Our environment, everything that we're doing is affecting us. So we want to make sure that we're getting the natural movements that our body's designed to do into our life, no matter where we're starting at. So one of the first natural movements is a squat, and you're getting that in to your life. So whether if you're sitting in an office job, you're making sure that you're getting some squats in some form or another. And it doesn't matter what your movement practice is. If you're somebody who loves going to the gym, if you're somebody who is just riding a horse and you're going to work and that's all that you do, but you go pick up some hay bales, you do one squat. That's a perfect start. You're in the kitchen, you go down to the bottom shelf on your pantry and you squat down instead of bending down. If you've got a little dog, my little dog's like this big, you squat down to their eye level. Doesn't matter what you do, in your life you're getting that full range of motion so that you're keeping that action happening in your hips. Because as soon as these get tight, it affects our lower back, it affects our upper back, it affects our posture, it affects our sitting trot, it affects everything, because we know how much work we do when we're sitting in the saddle, and if you haven't got the mobility through your hips, it affects everything. And so when we want to make sure that we're getting that squat in, then we want to make sure that we're getting lunging in as well. And then we're making sure we're getting other movements in, because one of the most neglected movements that we don't get into our life is twisting. And then we go and get that hay bale off the top lot of the haystack, and we bring that down, put in the wheelbarrow, and we've just popped something in our neck. And so when you keep your body mobile, it means you can keep enjoying your sport and you can keep yourself active, and then you can keep shining. But if you've got one type hip flexor because you spend your day driving a car like this, or you sit on your chair like this, and then you're spending all the money on an instructor to tell your horse not to, trying to get it to stop leaning off that rein, but all you're doing is doing that to the same environment on your hip, we've got to look at the whole complete picture and make sure that we're not holding ourselves back from the environment that we put ourselves into each and every day. So we are what we eat, and we are how we move our body. So we want to make sure that we become nutrient seekers. We're seeking out nutrients from our food, and we're keeping our food as simple as possible. just as our body craves nutrients from food, so just as we crave chocolate and coffee at about 3:30 in the afternoon and then about 4 wine cravings kick in, so too does our body crave movement. But often we don't listen to the movement cravings. When we get that upper ache in our back, or we get that tight hip, or we get just that kind of dull feeling, these are actually your body telling you that it's seeking out movement. You've been sitting too long. But often we might just then go get a massage, or we actually don't change the environment that we're putting our body into each and every day. So I want you to kind of just start to, like, you're listening to your body when it starts to not only crave certain foods, but it's also starting to listen to when it craves movement. Who's craving movement from sitting today? Yeah? So this, all these kind of things, you know, when you've been on a plane and that kind of feeling, people are putting their bodies into that same position every single day for 8 hours. But then you do little micro ones of that when you're putting your body into that for a couple of hours. And your body does tell you when it needs movement. And if you've been closed up like this, get out and move and open the body up and get it free, loosen up the hips and just think really simple. And just think about moving the body more and bringing more and more movement into your body and making sure you're getting those primal movements in as well. So every single movement can also deliver nutrients to your body. If you were to eat a diet full of just oranges, even if you were eating 2,000 calories of just oranges, you'd just be getting the nutrients delivered from just oranges. If you were to just move by only riding a horse, you're only getting the movement that that's creating. Then you're going to limit your range of motion in other areas as well. So then when it comes to picking up a hay bale, that section doesn't happen on a horse, but it might happen off the horse as well. So we want to make sure that we're constantly delivering movement, nutrients to our body. There's 57 different ways that you can sit on the ground. Each one of those ways, however I sit, delivers a different stretch to my body. That stretch is a nutrient, a movement nutrient, delivering it, making it feel good. So you know how I got you to stand up to start with when you're feeling tired, and I got you to breathe out? Movement was delivering nutrients to your body, making you feel good at a cellular level. We want to make sure that we get a huge variety of food so we get lots of nutrients into our diet, and a huge variety of movement so that we get lots of movement nutrients into us, because this is what's going to keep us on our horses to our last day on earth, keep us active, keep us thriving, keep us feeling awesome, and keep us really mobile as well. Sound good?
Yeah.
Okay, questions? Okay, cool. So first of all, we want to, if you were to look at a day to day, and if you've had a really busy day and you were to eat dinner really late, you've skipped dinner all day and you eat dinner really late, you've had a bad night's sleep because you ate dinner really late, and then you hop up and you're starting another cycle, that environment's going to give you different messages to say when you've got a really good night's sleep and you're able to eat when you're hungry and stop when you feel. So there's different messages that are happening, and we do all have busy lives, and we do all have situations where this always turns up. So what it means is you want to look at how you're spending your day and making sure that you're fueling your day for what it needs up ahead. If you have had a day where it hasn't worked and you've had to have dinner really late, then you're starting fresh the next day and making sure that you're fueling it to set yourself up for the next day up ahead. Does that make sense? So in my experience, that person who tells me they don't feel hungry in the morning is because they've had dinner at 9 o'clock at night and they've had their biggest meal at 9 o'clock at night. It all starts from working backwards. So that person would then, I'd say, okay, let's just start tomorrow. You're going to start this day fresh. You're going to get a really good nutrient-dense breakfast. It's going to be based off whole real food. And if you start your day in that way, then by the time you get to dinner, you're not going to be having to, you know, replenish the body from not eating throughout the whole day. But there are going to be days when it just turns out like that. So then all you do is you go, okay, right, I'm going to start today. I'm going to eat good breakfast and I'm fueling myself for the day ahead. You're constantly just thinking about the day at hand and doing the best that you can at that day at hand. And it's about fueling the body for what it needs coming up ahead. If you've got no breakfast, is about breaking the fast and about making sure that you're getting the energy you need. We don't need a whole lot of food to go to sleep. Yeah, and it's usually afterwards that's when we call into somewhere and we get whatever we can because we just need to replenish. So that's where your body stresses out when we're in a situation like that, especially if competing is nervous for you. So you're trying to give it what it needs on those days. So yeah, but it's also listening to your body as well. So I would hate to say that, I'd hate to say blanket approach, yes. It's about the individual person on that day. For some people, that kind of experience might be like nauseous. Like if I'm turning, it's just like I can't handle food right now, but I might have like a smoothie that I've made and I can sip on that because if I don't, I can feel some shakes or something coming on. Like it's about being really intuitive about your body and what you need on that day. Nobody else, but providing it with food that it needs.
Sorry, I've got a head friend doing my riding career who won't eat breakfast and, you know, leaving on a dentist on halfway around the cross-country course, running out of energy because he hasn't eaten. And these friends, always encourage them to have something, but a lot of them have those
Yeah, and it's a case by case, and you're always just trying to go by what you can do best on that day. And we learn from experience. You might get to that day and it's just like, oh, I'm never doing that again because I just hit the wall. So next time I'm going to be prepared. In terms of the type of food that you're going, you can't beat something you've made yourself and that you're putting the nutrients into it yourself versus something that you've bought. But if it's the only scenario, you're making sure that, again, you're looking at your ingredients and you're making sure you're getting the best you possibly can. Too often we get caught up on nutritional labels and trying to find certain things. Look at the ingredients. If you don't know what they are, your body doesn't know what it is either and it doesn't know what to do with it. So it's just going to get stored. It's going to do some things and it'll probably be still trying to work out what to do with that in a few years. So real food, your body knows what to do with it. Other questions? No? You're ready for your wine now. Yeah, Debbie.
No,
the best lunch in the world is leftover dinner. Always cook more. Always cook more, and you've always got it there for whatever time you need. And then it's just about, you only need to cook once a day. And the reason people skip lunch or things like that is because they think that they need to prepare again or make a sandwich again or do something again. Cooking extra food at dinner time takes no extra time, but it means you've got lunch sorted for the rest of your life. Just always cooking extra food for dinner, and then it's always there. And then it's generally, if you're cooking good dinners, it's always going to be a good lunch and you've got a good breakfast. You're kicking off. Yeah. So with all of that, that was a very, it's about the solid foundation, and that's what I want you to kind of take home. It's just about real food, moving more, and doing everything that we can so that we're helping our riding, we're not holding ourselves back, and just starting to treat our body as well as we do our horses. Like we put all this emphasis onto making sure we're getting them the right food, but we deserve that as well so that we can shine too. Yeah, so I run an online gym, and so that's foreverfit.tv is my main website, and so that's, we have foreverfit.tv, but I also have another website. It's called dressageridertraining.com, and that's it's core workouts for dressage riders, and it's got yoga workouts and everything, and I write weekly blogs about how to set up your neutral spine and everything. So dressageridertraining.com. And that's dedicated for dressage riders, all weekly blog articles all about health and fitness, nutrition for dressage riders and everything. So it's, I'm constantly putting out articles. And so the horse stuff is on dressageridertraining.com and foreverfit.tv as well.
How bad is sugar?
sugar is something that's got void of all nutrition. So sugar is completely processed, it's been stripped of everything, and it's, yeah, so the sugar that we want to be eating is sugar from real food. Fruit, if you're going to be doing baking, bake with, put a banana and some dates as your sweetener. Use things that have got the nutrients intact. So when in doubt of what you're eating and what you're choosing in terms of like sugar, you're making sure that it's got the nutrients with it, because our body, it needs other nutrients to be able to absorb them. When we have magnesium, we need zinc and we need calcium to be present. When we don't have those, we can't absorb them. So just taking
magnesium as just a supplement by itself doesn't work, but when we have it with other supplements, this is when we, sorry, other foods that's delivered with all the nutrients, this is when we get them delivered and our body knows how to use them. So sugar is literally just stripped of everything and it's just sugar. So we want to make sure. Yeah, and you don't, like, there's movies and everything about it all now, so you just don't have to look far to see the convincing article on sugar. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so when you look at like smoothies, for example, you've got to look at making sure you're giving your body what it needs. So for example, if you were to make a smoothie that's got pineapple, mango, strawberries, peaches, whatever else, is a whole lot of sugar, and you would not eat that if you were chewing a bowl of that much fruit. So when you have something like a smoothie, I've got my green smoothie here today. It has got one green apple, it's got celery, it's got cucumber, it's got kale, it's got avocado in it. It's got one fruit. You're constantly trying to make sure that you get vegetables into your diet, and when you're making something like a smoothie, you're eating it as if you were to eat just one apple. You wouldn't sit down and eat an apple and a banana and all those kind of things, because then that skyrockets your blood sugar levels, it affects your cravings later on, and then about an hour and a half after you've eaten that, you'll fall asleep. So we're constantly trying to make sure we just, you know, you're balancing your blood sugar levels and eating real food, and if in doubt, add more vegetables.
Thanks, Nicola. I think that was really informative for many of us. I think my takeaway message was I need to quit my sedentary day job and ride more.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally.
Because it's just no good for me working.
No.
Look, so thank you very much. We've got a gift for you.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. Beautiful.
Lovely. Yeah. So well done, everyone. We're at the conclusion of the workshops today. So we're on the downhill slide now into the cocktail function and the gala dinner. So you've got some downtime now. It's 5 to 5. But I just want to give you a little bit of a preview of what we've got coming up tonight. It's going to be really fun. So we've got the cocktail function and prize giving, which is down poolside where we had lunch earlier, and that's from 6 till 7 this evening. If you're a prize winner, please be there by 5:40 to get organised. After the, you'll also be given a voucher for a free drink at the cocktail function, and there will be nibbles down there as well. From there, we'll be herding you up, back up here to this room for the gala dinner. Now, take away with you anything you want, because we're going to be clearing the room and sort of theming it, so don't leave you any valuables or anything here that you want to take away. So 7 p.m. we'll be asking you to be back up here and ready to go. We've got quite a big evening planned. We've got the Canter for Cancer auctions happening, so we're going to be kicking off with a silent auction, which our MC of the evening will be giving a bit of briefing about what happens and how it works. You can see on the back wall there's a few bits and pieces that we're going to be auctioning off. We've got some amazing vouchers and things that people have given generously. Otterley's not here, but we'll be taking silent bids. If you can't make it along tonight and you want to place a silent bid, you can see me straight after this and we can record that for you. Following that, there'll be the main auction. We've got some great items. Peppers on the Point, which is an amazing luxury accommodation place here. All sorts of that beautiful lamp that you can see on display. All sorts of neat things. So bring your wallet with you or your checkbook and your dancing shoes, because we are going to be entertained in true Studio 54 style by DJ Shane tonight. So yes, DJ Shane, that's and also we're going to have spot prizes for the best dressed. So who's got a costume organised tonight? Right, because there is a magnum of bubbly up for grabs, a magnum.
So if you haven't got your costumes organised, well, you might be in trouble, but yeah, you've got an hour. So go refresh, do what you need to do, and come back all ready for some fun times tonight.
No worries. Yeah, you must be shattered.
Oh, I've filled my body with rubbish today, and now I'm feeling it.
Yeah, I don't have the nerve to ask, but what I said to Kat, ask how she makes her chocolate.